topic is microservice authentication role. So we will work with microservice. There is some authentication stuff we will do, and everything will be in Golang. There will be coding also. I will show the code, real code, and I will try to explain the concept. So there are means in practice there are a lot of way of authenticating in the microservice world, and there is no like a very well like full and final one. That this is the one people are generally going with, because still it is evolving. But I'm going to so one of the approach which is sophisticated enough, and it is like one of the very well known way of doing the stuff. Let's go ahead. So this is the example I'm going to just talk during the demo. So this is my simple application. So client, web browser, using curl or web browser, you can make a request to the microservice application. I have a book service, I have a root service. It's like this, like I just say, okay, book. There is some website called book.io. If I just hit that one, it will show me the list of the books. So they will give the details of the books, and this will also return few reviews for the books, not all the reviews, right? And there is something called review service, which will, if you say that, okay, this is my book ID, it will give all the reviews. Fine. So this is the idea. So it will just say get API books ID equal to 1. It will return the details of the book ID 1. What are the details? Book details and few reviews. Fine. Now, if you directly make a call from client that I want a book reviews, like get API reviews book ID equal to 1, then it will return you all the reviews. For a book service to get the reviews, it has to make a call from here to here to the review service. Okay, so this will be having only book details. Okay, but the book review details is here. See, in microservice world, the database are separate. This will be having a separate database. This will be having separate database. This will be having a database where only book related information is there, like book name, author, price, likewise. This will be having details where for each book, what are the reviews? Like there are 1,000 reviews, there are 100 reviews, 5 reviews, 10 reviews. Okay, and that will be stored in this database. If you want the accumulated view, then these things has to be called these things, get the review and take the book details from the database of book service and return it. Clear this example? Fine. So I will just I will try to run these things also so that we can, okay.
Can you zoom it a bit? Zoom.
Still. So this is my book service running, and this is my review service running. So we need to choose a different port, right? Just let me know if things are not. Okay, so currently I have two services running. Okay, and let me try to run these things from, for example, here itself. Okay, let me put it from this one. So I will say localhost 8082. Okay. API books and ID equal to 1. So here you can see that. For there, I have passed this book ID equal to 1, and it has written me the book details, ID name, author, price, which is coming from the book service. And then it has written me two reviews, okay, top two reviews kind of things, and which is coming from review service. Now I will talk with the review service directly. So it is running obviously on the different port, which is 8083 API / reviews and book ID equal to 1. Now you see that they have four reviews. Book ID 1 has a four reviews. But in the previous call, you can only see two reviews because this is how the setup has been done. And this makes sense, fine? So is this example is clear? Okay, and we have the running demo running, fine? So we can also verify the stuff. Let's go to the next So now we need to talk about the authentication in this particular stuff, right? There is no authentication here, right? It's like that, it's like a plain endpoint. You can call it the way I called from the browser, you can call it, and there is no authentication details you have passed. Now I will go to the next level where we have auth service. See, in the microservice world, there is always, like, you will find there is one dedicated service which is an auth service, which will take care of authentication stuff. So generally what happens, the client will first make a call, post call with API login kind of endpoint, and it will pass username and password. It is in the body of payload, right? And once that is go to the auth service, it will return something called token kind of things, right? Subsequent call, you need to use that token and call this book service or review service likewise. And this token has to be validated. So when book service will get that token, okay, it will talk to the auth service and it will say, okay, validate this token. If the token is validated, then only book service will reply to the client. Similarly, now see, little complex, right? Similarly, if you call from client to here, it will again say that, okay, is it, it got the token, it will make a call, validate call to the auth service, whether it is a valid or not. Makes sense. Now think about this thing. When client browser will make a call to book service, it will first say whether it is valid token or not. Fine? First thing. It is valid, it will view the book data. But before that, it needs to get the review data. So it will make a review service call with the token. Okay? The review service, what it will do? It will again do validate the token. Okay, for the same call, once it is validated, we are validating second time. And then review service say, okay, this token is valid. Then it will return the data to the book service, and book service will club the data and finally return to the client. Is this flow is clear? I'm not going to run this flow in the live code. You can always see that there are two problems in this. First, you are multiple times you are validating the token, fine? In this particular, these are very normal scenario. Like when you open an Amazon website, when it will show you the what are the items, what are the inventory, what are the details of that one, what are the reviews, what are the rating, what are the price, what is like depending on your recommendation, they will make one call. But once it will reach to the Amazon service, first service, it will make 10 different calls to the 10th service, and each 10th service will be validating the same token. And now this is one problem. The other problem is that auth service. Now the auth service become bottleneck, because like everybody is talking to auth service for every call. It's like that. If you are getting 100 calls, that 100 calls may become 500 calls to the auth service, which is very so normal scenario. So this is the problem. So this is not the ideal solution. One more thing you need to observe is here that in microservice world, we don't have this session kind of things. You know, in the monolithic one, we always have like that, okay, when you talk to the auth service, okay, it will not return a token, it will return a session ID. Okay, it will be set in the cookie. And the next time the client will make a call, it will just send the session ID. And what auth service will do, see, for this session ID, what is the corresponding authentication payload? And it will say, okay, this is still valid and all, and it will forward the call. But in case of microservice, that is not possible. So they have come with the concept of token, which is like stateless. The token itself has a lot of information. If you just pass it around, it is able to self-authenticate itself. Fine. This token is encrypted one, and it required a lot of stuff to decrypt it. But this is self-sufficient. So this is a stateless authentication kind of things, you can say. Fine. Is it clear? Any question so far? Everything good? Okay, let's go to the problem. Now let's solve this problem of validate token multiple times first. No, first let's solve the problem with the auth service, which is a bottleneck. Auth service is a bottleneck, fine? Let's first solve that problem. So this is the one of the way you can actually solve these things. What is there? See, it is totally same. Here instead of token, we are returning something called JWT token. Okay? Now JWT token, it's like that this auth service has something called private key. So when they get the request of username and password, they will actually create this JWT token with the one private key. So it will use, while encrypting the token, it will use private key. Now the concept is very simple. Once the JWT token comes to the client, in the following request, the client will make a call with the JWT token. Now book service will be having public key. So there is a private key, private means this RSA key will always have public key and private key, right? So you will encrypt the data, you will actually generate a token with the private key. But when you get this token in the book service, it will be in public key. And with the public key, you can actually validate the token. Okay? So this is how the JWT token, when generated with the private key, works. You will generate the token with the private key, return it. The subsequent services, make a call. Obviously, here the authentication is happening. If the password is wrong, it will reject the request. But if the password is right, then it will return a JWT token which is created out of a private key. Okay, we will see in the code how it is. But just understand, there is a private key which will generate a token. That token comes. If I have a token, if I have a public key, I can validate it. Okay, and once I validate, I can say, okay, I will give the, I'm ready to return book service data. Then I will make a call to review service with the same token. The review service also has a public key. It will also once again validate and it will return the review data. And ultimately, the, it is locked and given to the client. Client can directly make a call to review service also. In that case, only the validate token of the review service with the public key happen. And this is the thing. So we have solved. Yeah. Yeah, means the RSA 256 that. Public private key which we generate, right? I will show you that private key, public key. But the idea is clear. Okay. In the previous one, there is a problem that the auth service is bottleneck because everybody is calling auth service, validate, validate, validate. Now, if you don't want to make that things, fine, then this is already, this mechanism is there in place where you can generate a JWT token with private key and validate with the public key. Now here also there is one problem, fine, because we are validating the token multiple times. That is one problem. What is second problem? We need to distribute this public key to all the services. So your this private key you need to secure it. But for example, this private key is compromised. Then you will replace this private key. Once you replace this private key in the auth service, you need to replace all where public keys. Fine. But yeah, that is still fine. Like, but the main problem which we are saying that we are validating the token multiple times. So we'll go to the next solution. Any question? Cool. Yeah. So there is something called API gateway in case of microservice architecture. Like this is one pattern kind of things which people refer. So API gateway is what? See, just forget the auth service as of now, because auth service has nothing to do with API gateway, because the name API gateway say it has something to do with API, right? So the API gateway function is very simple. See, this book service, review service, okay, they have some API which expose, and if the client is calling directly that API, whenever you change something here, you need to also change to the client. Now, for example, there are 5 services. Okay, and client wants to sum some data from 5 services. Like there is a one big web page, and they want to lazy load the 5 services data. So it need to make 5 different calls, and it has dependency on all 5 services. Instead of that, the API gateway comes, which is meant for the API aggregation and API routing kind of things. Right. So what it will do, client will always talk to this guy only one endpoint. Say that give me all the catalog details. So it will call for book service, it will call review service, it will call this pricing service, it is called stock service, whether it is available or not, and everything it is logged, and it will give to the client, and browser will show that okay, this is the book but it is out of stock, this is the book it has 5 rating, this is the book but the price is this, all the things will be there. So that is where API gateway comes into the picture. So what API gateway is doing, it routes the request to the different service. It's doing a routing. And once it's do a route, there is possibility that it can just do a routing. Like it will just take the request and forward it to here, and whatever response comes, it will give it back. It's a routing. It can also do the aggregation. Where API gateway will make a call to service 1, get the response, service 2, get the response, service 3, get the response, club all the response, give it to the client. So these are 4 API gateways there. So we need to solve the same problem, because now API gateway is a powerful pattern where we have everything in the central control. Fine. Now, there is an idea there, because this API gateway will be also running as a separate container, fine, in the microservice world. So let's utilize this API gateway for doing this authentication also. Now, authentication is considered as an edge function. Edge function. So what is edge function? You have a request. Okay. Once the, you will do something before the request. See, the request is give me the book details. Okay. But you will do something before the request and you will do something after the request. You can do something before the request, like you can log the start time and you can log the end time at the end of the request, and you will find what is the your turnaround time, fine. So these are for edge function, okay? And you can do this edge function. Authentication is also one kind of edge function, okay, which you can do in API gateway. Okay, you can actually separate one edge service here before the API gateway and can do with authentication there. But it is like that you will running another container. There is one more hop will be there. So latency issue and everything. And you have one more component to handle, which is the edge service. So instead of that, you will plug that edge function here. So you will do first authentication here. Now, how you will do that authentication? With the API gateway. So first, client will make a request that I want to log in. It will give user and password. Now, API gateway, it will be having some idea that if there is a call to the login, route it to the auth service. It will just route to the auth service. Whatever response comes, it will come back. It's just doing the routing, fine. It has no knowledge. It has just only knowledge that if the call is login, give to auth service, whatever coming back, give it to this. So in this case, the call will go to the auth service. It will return a JWT token. It will return to the browser. Now, next call. Client will make for the book request. I want book details. So it will come here. Now, it knows that this has to be validated. See, this call never has to be validated, fine? Because you are starting the interaction with the services like Amazon.com, you need username and password. When you say okay, you are not passing any authentication detail. You are only passing your username and password. And once you get the token, for every other request you are doing subsequently after login, you are passing a token. So when you want the book details, you will pass a token to API gateway. And API gateway knows that okay, it has to be routed to the book service, but it has also to be this authentication. So now the same concept, it will be in public key, it can validate this token. If it is fine, it will forward it to the book service. Similarly, if you want the review details, you come here, it authenticate with the public key, return the review. And even like when you want book details, come here, it will make call here. There is no validation happening. Come here, come back. So we have solved the problem with multiple validation. There are some issues with this one, but this is the final one which I'm going to take and show it to you as a live coding example. Make sense? Any question?
No, this can be the model like
it. Okay, gateway. It's a stateless. You can make it like, you can replicas like 10, 100, whichever you are. So, see, these are all stateless. Even host service is kind of stateless, right? Host service may not be a bottleneck, but in the previous example, fine? Right? In this, I'm saying that okay, auth service will become a bottleneck. It may see, you can also, auth service is also like a stateless, right? Okay, stateless, you understand it has no need to bother about the first request, second request, third request, right? Even though it is coming from the same client, right? So auth service, you can actually make multiple replicas, but you are validating multiple times. This is the problem, right? Now, this API gateway, there is no like auth API gateway kind of concept. There is an API gateway kind of concept, because API gateway does lot of stuff, and you can also add the auth service here. You can do other way around, where you can say auth service, I want to make an API gateway, right? But it's just like the thinking. It's just like one thing, which is like a tunnel. It's like a facade. If you know the facade pattern in the Java world or in our object oriented world, where there is a something called facade pattern. So it will actually just like hide all your services and give one facade. So API gateway is a facade with respect to the microservice world. Cool.
Can you limit authorization to this method? For example, can you say that our client is only authorized to get book service but not review service?
Yeah. So in the JWT token, I will show you that you can also say that what is the role of this particular guy. When the username and password comes, it understands that this is a customer. And it will add a details in the JWT token that the role equal to customer. And once it comes here, and they say, okay, this is a role is equal to customer, give it to them. But the role is not equal to admin, then don't give the, for example, allow to edit the boot book prices.
Basically, JWT token has something called privilege. That privilege can be regex pattern or anything. So, like here, we explained as role based. Here, there, you can make it RPC, like you have function based also. So, if you have, if I'm using RPC, then you can suppose this client is should access 1, 2, 3 functions, not 4, 5. So, you can define regex for that particular token. Right? And then the in your JWT validation, you validate the regex. So there is something called privilege, you can define your.
Yeah. So the full form of JWT is JSON web token. And it is like a JSON payload. Okay. And in the JSON, if you you can put all these things, what he told, like you can put role equal to customer because it's JSON data only. You can put that, okay, what are the allowed function? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What are not allowed function? 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Likewise. I will show it to you. Let's see the code.
Just one question here. So here, service will, you can interact with review service without interacting through API gateway.
Yeah, that's what I told. That there is a problem with this solution also. Fine. Yeah. So hold your question. There, I already told there is one problem with this thing. Fine. But don't bother on that thing. That also has been handled. But I will first show you this one because let me show you the coding also. And then we will discuss about the problem with this problem with this particular architecture design and what is the solution for that. Fine. Cool. So now how many components are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we need to run 5 steps. Fine. So I will be running 5 separate command prompt. Okay, which will be each are 5 different. Like this way. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And this can actually run on my laptop all together or on 5 laptop separately. Fine. Okay, so this is my client where I will be making a request. This is my API gateway. Okay, so let me run my API gateway. It's running. Now this is my auth service. Okay. This is my book service. This is my review service. Okay. Fine. Visibility wise. Okay. So now client will be making first call for the authentication, API login, fine, first call. Let's do that call. Yeah, so this is the call. Make a post request to localhost 8080. My gateway is running on 8080. Okay, so everything will go to the 8080. API login is the endpoint. This is the data, username equal to early, password equal to abcd123. Means just for a testing purpose, we are just showing the password. And let's run this thing. So what will happen? This will come to API gateway. Then? To API gateway. And then? Here we will see the token. So you can see that this has got API login request. This is good login request. It has written the token and the token came here. Okay, see the token, how it looks. This is how the token looks like, fine. So you can't figure out anything. But it is actually the plain password, plain token that we will come to things later. So let me copy this guy and put me equal to export token equal to 2. Token 2 equal to this one. So I kept inside a variable called token2. And now let's, so this login, this client, web browser, Skull, whatever, has done the successful login. It has got the token. Now it is his responsibility that in the subsequent call, it should pass the token. So now they want book. It won't book, and I will make the token equal to 2. So what it is doing? Again, local host 8080. Why 8080? API gateway. API books. ID equal to 1. So it is talking to book service. It wants to book, talk to the book service. Then authorization, we are a token 2, which is what we stored. And I will make a request. So how it will go? It will come from here to API gateway. Then book service. Then review service. Then book service. Then API gateway. Then back. I will remove everybody. And let me run this. Okay, the output has come. So first, it has come to the API books. The request has been received. It has gone to here. So book request ID equal to 1 has come. Then so review request book ID equal to 1, limit equal to 2. Because the book, when you make a call to the book service, you only fetch few reviews. And then it returns 2 reviews, limit 2, and it will come here. So let's see this particular payload. Okay. So this is book called microservice pattern. It is $50 and there are 2 reviews. One is by Himal, one is by Money. Okay. Now make call another things. Let's directly talk to the books review service. Fine. There's another call that also you can do. So how it will go? Correct. But I will make this latest token. So again, make localhost 8080 to the review service, book ID equal to 1, and this is my token. So it will come to the API gateway, it will go to the book service, it will come to the review service, no book service, and it will return the response. So let's clear this guy. So API reviews call has come, book ID limit equal to 0, so it will return all the limits. Cool. So you understand the design, the live running demo, and I will now go through few coding, which is actually used in this one. I have made the things very simple in the coding aspect, so that we will actually understand. See, API gateway, what kind of coding it will be having. There are sophisticated API gateway stuff, like Spring has their API gateway, Netflix has their API gateway. So Spring does not have, Netflix has their API gateway. Spring has their authentication server, security solution kind of thing. So in API gateway, the responsibility is very simple. Forward the request, examine the path and forward it to some path. And you need to authenticate also depending on the request. So that is how it is done. So gateway, gateway, all the requests, okay, all the requests coming to the gateway will go to the router. This is go code, fine. So how this is where, so router, what it will do, see, if the login call comes, forward directly to the 8081 where our auth service is running. If the books call come, then forward it to 8082 where our book service is running. When review is come, forward the call to 8083. Now not one more thing, that in case of API login, you no need to do the authentication. So there is no call to the authentication. But in case of API books and API review, you need to make authenticate. So you are doing authentication here. And if nothing is there, you will just say that routing not found for this particular path. That's it. So you will just say what is you are doing from the request, you are taking the path of the request. You will say, well, if the path is API login, forward it to this. Likewise, fine. So now API gateway only need to bother. There is something called book service running on 8082, fine. And client, who is the call client, never need to go to what is 8082, 8081, 8083, like this, fine. So this is the call. Now it will come to the authenticate, fine. But that we will come later. First, I will show you the auth service where will you do generate the token, fine. Now in auth service, you will get this API login call. Okay. When you get this API login code, forward it to login method, and the login it will do a lot of stuff, right? But what it ultimately doing is that give me the token. If everything looks fine, give me the token for this guy.
Now how the token will be there? This is the token.
So user, it is my business user, fine. It's my business data, user ID and password and email address and all the things. So I want to generate a token. I will be passing some claim. So I am passing what claim? What is sub email of this guy? Sub is this unique ID of this particular guy, the user. Email is email and role equal to customer. This is where the authorization you can handle later on. And these things, use this one and give me the token. Okay. Now what generate token is doing? Generate token has something called private key. Okay. So it will take this token, JWT token, it will create things in the JWT token, pass this particular claims, which has come from this user, email, role. Okay. And then it will use this private key and it will create a token out of there, and that token will be returned. Okay. And you see that this private key is, there is something called simple key. I have with the auth service. Yeah, we are setting. See, this is the expiry we are setting. It is 1 day now plus 1 day. See, there are lot many things in the authentication, right? But means there are also variances also. Like this token, like you need to make sure that this token, if I return this token and my private key is compromised, then I will change my private key. I will change my public key and somebody will come with this token, okay? The old token, which is still valid because 1 day is not over. Then once you get this one, the public key will not be able to validate it. You got that scenario? You return a token with a private key, okay, for 1 day validity. After returning the token, the token is with you. After 2 hours, my security is compromised. So in my system, I have replaced the private key with some other private key. So public key will also be replaced. Now after 3 hours, you will make a call with your token, but my public key will not be able to authenticate because your token is valid, but I have changed my private public key. So those are the edge cases, but it has to be handled. There are ways to handle it. There is something called refresh token and likewise other stuff, right? But I am not considering this as of now. So this is private key, there is simple key, and I can show you that with the auth service. So this is my auth service, full code, fine. And it has something called sample key. You can actually delete this public key. Sample key is required with the auth service. And this is how the sample key looks like. It's just like a generated one, RSA private key. You need to keep it secure, fine. And once you get this token, you will just convert it to raw token. And you will return that token to the user. Now, how do you validate? The other way, like with the public key, fine. So you see my gateway. Gateway has something called public key. You see here. You see gateway, it has public key. And this is the public key. Now gateway will be using public key. So when they get this request, it will do authenticate. When it is doing authenticate, it will doing validate token. And in validate token, it is using this verify key, which is nothing but the public key quoted from the disk. So just like this way, validate. So all the code will go like this, and with the public key you can validate it. If you change the key, if you change the token, this API gateway will not allow you to go ahead. Fine. Now coming to what else? I think these are the main things. Fine. The rest is the book service and review service, which is like okay, any REST API endpoint. Fine.
Okay. What was the issue with that?
Yeah, let's come with this one. That's what this guy also was telling.
How is this private key secure?
You need to store in secure. You will store generally in your database, right, with whatever security.
See, those things will be there in any architecture, fine? You need to make sure.
Anyone will be in the private keys. The private key is nothing but it's like a security token, like with which you will encrypt the data. You have security key. Sometimes you will say, I have a security key. Okay. And sometimes you will say, I have a private key. But you need to secure it. But the thing is that you need to only secure with one database because you are storing with one only. There are also other JWT tokens, variances. Where to validate that particular JWT token, you need to also have private key on all the services or whichever want to validate. Okay, in this particular one, with a public key you can validate, but there is a variances where if you want to validate, you still need a private key. But there are different variances. Now coming to the fundamental issue with this one, that is what, see, this book service is running on 8082. This is running on 8083. Okay, and now if you are able to get the IP address of this one, I told you these five services are running on my laptop, but you can run on five different machines. And if you, I know the IP address of that machine, I can actually take the IP address, put 8082, put book, and I can get the data of the book service out of without doing any authentication. Now to secure this one, you need to actually make sure that, like Kubernetes, if you know, if you run in the Kubernetes, you can say that I don't want to expose this service at all.
Right.
There is no endpoint.
And if I don't even want to expose my service out of my
data. I mean, see, I don't, at a networking level, I don't know the solution, but I know what is the problem. I don't know how to solve it because I have not tried it. I've just read it. So I can't, I don't have a thorough understanding of how to make this secure. But perfectly, this can be secure. So if you are going with this architecture, this is one of the finest stuff you can see. We have shown what is the problem, what is the solution. Once you reach to this particular thing, if you are going with this particular architecture with your company or whatever your work, then you need to figure it out there how to solve this problem. Once you solve this problem, I think that's it. But as far as I read, you have to have Kubernetes running and you need to have Istio in the Kubernetes, which will do some MPLS kind of virtual PLS. Okay, I don't know that things because I run out of time when I reach to that particular part of this.
But in general, what is indicated
to
be
exposed to
internet?
Yeah, yeah. If hacker wants, then once, there is a way that you can actually do that. But if you still want to stop that, there is something called Kubernetes with Istio, where even hacker can't go inside there.
No, it's okay. What he meant means, so what the problem is, it's in, what he's saying is, he does not understand that what he talks about VPC is also right.
That's also
you can limit that.
Yeah.
What he's also saying that within the Kubernetes system, you can say that I don't want it to be exposed to the foreign. So there are multiple solutions. It's not a, you cannot have a predefined one notion that this is what is right. It depends upon your architecture and the need. What's the depends on various factors, right? Yes. Latency, need, what's the how much security you want, what do you want, refresh token and all. And his talk was basically to give the basic overview how it can
be. See, I'm telling you, I don't know, right? But you need to figure it out. But there is a way. There is no flaw with this particular architecture. It's just like that, we need to just find that. But now let's, final thing, anything else?
Things like here, you're running each and every service on a particular port. And generally, we don't run service on a particular port. Its port is randomized.
It's not a sophisticated solution.
No,
if you see the API gateway, no. See, try to understand. If I put everything inside this particular example, you will lose. It's like a dynamic IP, dynamic port. Everything will be there, right?
Maybe like when some book service is talking to review service, so book service must know which port review service is running.
Otherwise,
he will not be able to control.
Yes.
But if he doesn't know, then what should we do?
So there is something called service registry. There is something called service registry, which I have not covered in this architecture. So there will be something like the old service, there will be one service registry. And from that service registry, each service will know that if book service will query to the registry service to get where is the review service. Okay. It is even more complicated, right? Even you get this particular one and you got one IP, but now there are five book service instances running. If you just talk to one IP, then you will actually putting a load on one review service, one instance of the review service. So there are also those variances. Okay. It's there. Just like it's out of.
So that's the responsibility of orchestration platform, right? If you are using Kubernetes, it's the responsibility of how you expose a service. So service handles that dynamic port kind of thing and load balancing, right?
So there, that's where the proxy
comes in. If you are using some other Docker based or orchestrator, you use something like Istio or Envoy, Envoy proxy to, you know, orchestrate that kind of situation. So that does not lie in this responsibility, but still to make it clear, that's another top on its own.
Yeah, because see, this microservice architecture, service discovery is a different. So microservice architecture, there are a lot many things. Just concentrate on this box and something with respect to this. Otherwise, there are a lot many things which even I can, that's what edge service I told about. There are also other stuff. Okay, now just the final thing, and let's, we can close the session, which is this JWT token, fine? So this is the JWT token which we have generated, fine? So let me just show you what is this token too, fine? So I will just copy the, see, I will not explain you what is this JWT token looks like, means internal details. But there is something called JWT.io website. If you go there, see, if you go there, then they can know that this is a RSF256 algorithm, JWT token. Ali is the username, ali@gmail.com is a email. His customer, his sub ID. You understand? If you will get these things, okay, you will come to know that all this information. And now you will change the email address of yours and you put your ID. Sub ID equal to 1, put your 2. And with this token, you can actually start working with the stuff, because you will think that, okay, if I change these things, then I can just regenerate this stuff. But that is not the case, right? That is also secure. So I told you initially, JWT token is a plain token actually. So you can read everything out of this. These are the only two information which is stored. One is this, these are the information which is stored. Fine, you can see it right away. But you can't actually, if you change something here, this will be changed. And once you change this one, and if you send it to this one, the API gateway will reject this for sure. And how? And I can also show you that if you have a public key, which is this public key, if you just take this public key, and if you just give it this public key to this JWT token, you see it's an invalid signature, it is saying currently. Now you just put this, paste this public key, and it will say that it's signature verified. So with the public key, it can also, it is just, I'm showing that it can validate the token. Now you change something, it will say that no, this is not the one. So if you change here 1 to 2, okay, the token will be changed and this will become invalid, right? Well, JWT token, I'm not coming, right? JWT token has their own structure and how to use it. There are a lot many things with the JWT token. And JWT token has also two variances. JSON Web Security and JSON Web Encryption, something like that. JSON Web Signature and JSON Web.
The ports are available. So, like C++, JWT has a lot of issues. So, we manually fixed and pushed it. Whoever is author.
Yeah, but JWT is like
it's
norms
standard,
for token.
API is available.
So, this is there. He's just saying that what are the algorithm, what are the client supported, everything is there, like Python. So, you can just generate a token with algorithm in a different language, validate also in a different language. You can generate with the Go, validate with Python. Can you increase it? Loud. That is private key. It's just like a combination, it's like a pair, fine? One is like this is a public key and simple, this is a private key. You can generate a private key, public key combination, fine? Which means it's just like any random key you can generate. And then this private key you will use to generate token. The other one, public key, you will use to validate the token. That's it, guys. Anything else? Okay. My name is Noor Ali. I'm from company Red Hat. I like rolling microservices. So I just want to show you these things that So this is the book Microservice Patterns. You can refer and with a lot of knowledge with respect to the microservices. I like this book. It has a lot of good material, like very well, like it's like Game of Four sort of thing with respect to the microservices. And means, and there is another book which I refer, which is Go in Excel for a brush of my ghost. But yeah, the microservice pattern is like. I'll talk to you later. I have free one. Cool. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
I have a question. How do you handle session sort of invalidation or blacklisting some tokens in this? Because since this is stateless, there must be some kind of trade-off that we take against that as compared to stateful. Like it's easy to blacklist some tokens or.
If you say that this is my private key, public key chain, then you need to make sure that so you will be in list of public key, right? It's not like that. You have one public key, second public key, third public key. Generally, it happens like that. In generally people do list. They will have in something called key ID.
What he's talking about, once you publish the JWT token, right? So for particular one JWT token out of 1000 JWT token, you want to blacklist it. So
like that, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. So like, he's not talking about this token.
So you put one day.
And I think I need to complete the other part of the book.
No.
I don't know. Thank you.
So
if anyone knows, just
that is the genuine. So
whatever benefits you get out of JWT, if you need that kind of approach, again you have to sort of have a task where you store JWT and then put it sort of invalidated.
Becomes stateful.
It's just a performance penalty. Basically, you're using JWT so that you don't hit some database. Which will be more expensive, but then you might, if you want to check up invalid tokens, you might look up a more faster cache of some sort.
See, if, even though in case of monolithic architecture, if you want to go, you need to keep the cache, and then only you can do this thing. Invalidate one particular token. We don't have caching. If you add the caching, it has some cons, but then you can do that thing. But like you know,
I think I can just start. Just to also set the context, so if you use some common authentication service, we store all the tokens for every user. So what he means by blacklisting or some people is like you can find an attacker and then you can actually remove this token so that he cannot talk to the backend services. So basically we have a state, but the whole problem is this becomes a single point of failure and everybody talks to this auth service. That is what avoided by JWT, where you don't have any intermediate state. Rather, the client is directly having it open and it's authenticated.
Yeah.
Now, how will we do blacklisting is, we don't have a mechanism because there is no state. I think the point there is, there we will have a higher, what do you call that, session period, which is like 30 days or something. And then like if you want to blacklist or remove it, we do it. But I think here in JWT, you can reduce that period. Like keep it for some hours or some days. So it's not very complicated to create a token, right? I think that is a one way to avoid that problem. But especially getting rid of that user, I think you have to talk to the clients and then say sort of remove it, something like that. I don't know who did you guys work on it? I think I can talk to the other folks and then they have done something like they had to write some special code to get rid of those tokens by talking to the clients because we don't have anything.
Yeah.
So that is obviously tricky. Yeah, tricky.
No, but you can have a fast cache where you do a quick lookup.
No, there is no cache here, right? Client has the tokens.
Correct.
It's become a bottleneck like the
what this particular token is
validated. So the token has validity. Like it says till this duration you have it.
They're talking about that listing.
You can't
do it without introducing state.
Yes.
You
know,
but I think a lot of people are crash about the use with shorter duration.
That's the
mitigation does not avoid it.
Yeah.
You're right. At the end of the day, it ends up being a problem. Yeah. That is the biggest drawback of JWT.
There's always a pros and cons like between stateful and stateless. The decision is based on the application that you have.
So most of the points go that the pros of JWT are so good that particular con, which is the biggest one, which has is kind of one in a million case. And if you can use cache or anything to speed up that problem, you kind of make it minimal, but it again doesn't solve the problem. And that is the drawback.
That microservice is still not like a mature, there are a lot of enhancement going on, and that's why we have not come to the final one. This is the way to do the authentication. There are corner cases, but it is the area of research, right? That's it.
Who worked on JWT? Yeah, just brought up in systems. Okay, just look at them and then you guys can answer the questions or like talk more later. If you have more questions, please post it. I think we also don't know more. I think we'll collect the information and then probably share the information. Just to cut the discussion. Because later, obviously, you guys can talk over the learning process, so that's much better. Thank you so much, Nirali.
If any feedback, just give it to me. Last time, one guy gave me the feedback that you should add one slide because, and then I put this slide and.
We'll collect it and give it to you. We'll collect it. So the next talk is by Ankur Anand, and then he works on SAP Hubs. So the talk is going to be about memory allocation in Golang. Previously, also we discussed this in. You can connect. Previously, also we discussed this in a remote meetup which we had. I don't know how many of you have read, like, but probably for the beginners, like if you have seen other systems which uses GC garbage collection, it needs compaction and all, and then Golang doesn't have it. Like, how does it figure out? There's a lot of nice things or proposals which Golang adopted, and then the memory allocation plays a huge role in it. Like, I think we'll talk more about in detail and TCM a lot. You also have code, you know, right? I think it's more of a conceptual level than more code.
That is a real candidate we're talking about. Performance analysis.
Yeah, I mean, obviously GC is there, but there are much more, like, why the GC latency is very less in Golang? Because it doesn't have some configured things like compaction. Not generational GC, which you can compare with Java. And memory, like a lot of other pieces of the runtime plays a huge role. And memory allocation is also something really great. So yeah, this talk is going to cover that. You're joining Zoom and also sharing the screen, right?
Yeah.
So how many of you have read the GC Java concepts? Okay. He needs to set the context outside. Like, I don't know how many people have researched about it, like why Golang is faster. Like, if you have looked at the deployment times, right? Go has much lesser spin-up time compared to other languages. Like, probably you compare with Java, it takes 30 seconds or more than that. That is because JVM, all the stuff is very, I think, very well. And then runtime plays a huge role also. So that concept also is really interesting. Like, co-scheduler, memory allocation, GC, everything. Like, you guys should check it out. You're started.
attention, right? Which is showing me.
We're actually recording all the videos and then putting it up. Also, some people are joining, so that's why this. That's just a thing. Yeah.
Okay, it's visible to everyone?
Yeah.
Okay. So, hi everyone. So I work for, my name is Ankur Anand.
Can you mute the speaker? Can you mute your speaker?
Yeah. That's fine. And I work for SAP Lab India. And this talk is basically to give you overview of all the components or all the data structure involved with the Go memory allocation. Since it's a large thing in itself, I won't be covering each and every details, but I would make sure that you have a fair bit of idea about from the system level to go till Go memory allocation, so that you can go on your own, and if you are interested, you can go and research on the topic, how to read the source code and get more into it. So it's this question is not to gauze anyone, but just to get a fair bit of idea, how should I pace this talk? How many of you actually works with, in any point of in life, with the virtual memory at the OS level and all those stuff? Okay. So, okay, first of all, before going to virtual memory, so I know most of the time it does not make sense, because lots of time people hide away so much of abstraction from you. So I will be talking about RAM, because yes, being a non-computer science graduate, when I started doing learning about virtual memory, it was not making sense to me. So I did learn whatever I faced difficulty, I will try to cover it up for everyone. So everyone, when I talk about the virtual memory in Go, we all are on the same page, at least. So how does the RAM looks inside? This is just for the representation overview. How does you, once we think about RAM, we think it about an individual, as a whole. We never thought about what goes inside it. So every bit that you store inside the RAM, I'm not talking about the byte or gigabyte or megabyte, every bit that you store inside the RAM, it is stored inside its own cell. That cell is something composed of the capacitor and the transistor. So how does it store any times that it knows that it has one or zero? So capacitor, if you are familiar, it stores charges. So once the charge is stored, this at that particular location, one, if the charge is there, we know that there is the bit is set, it is one. If the charge is discharged, it's zero. So lots of thing goes on in between. You put the address in the address line, and then the capacitor has to, periodically recycle, because you lose charges on the capacitor and all those things. So this is what at the memory cell level at the each RAM looks like. And you have data lines and address lines. Address lines gives you which bit you want to access, and the data lines gives you the what is the data store at, is it zero or one. So this is the overall picture for the 8-byte RAM. You have a data bus through which the data travels. You have the address line through which you put down the address from the CPU. And the control bus is used to control sort of things. In the majority, there are lots of things goes on, but you can think of, is this write operation or read operation at the fundamental level. So if you think about this is a 8-byte RAM, means total 64 cells. So there are total 8 cells in each row, such cells. Okay, once we talk about how many times you have seen like with for, okay, 32-bit system, I cannot exceed more than the 4GB RAM. Even if I put the 64GB of RAM, it won't make sense to the operating system. Why? Because you cannot access that many RAM location. So once you have the address lines, right? So 32-bit system, that means you can only put 32 zeros and ones in that. So 32 zeros and ones means you can only have the address. So here is the lowest address. Byte, okay, RAM is only byte addressable. You cannot think about this one, byte addressable. You have different homes, right? You can only have the address of the homes, not the individual bricks that made up that homes. Postman cannot deliver the letter to the, those individual bricks, but it will deliver to that home address. The same way, address line, so this address lines, all these address lines, sorry, all these 8-bit of memory location will give in one address. What will be the address? That depends upon the, what is the total number of address line your CPU architecture supports. When we talk about the 32-bit pointer, what we are saying is, my address line is, there are 32 address lines. So this entire will be given, address will be composed of the 32-bit zeros and ones. For the 64, so here if you see lower one, I gave the address, what is the address? I have this address, 30, total 32-bit of that address. The higher you get a total of, means the high, in this case, you have the all ones that makes the address. So at the RAM, you have the byte addressable and plus this number of address lines does not gives you the number of admins, number of physical RAM. If you have worked with any read about 8086, you have seen 16, there was 16, you can have 16-bit address line, but 4-bit you can actually address 20 bytes addressable. So they had this notion. So it's just the physical overview that this is how the address lines and everything composed of at the RAM. Bit of visibility. Before going. So this is how your program looks like in the memory. So anytime you run a program, this I think we might have all seen somewhere in anywhere in our life, right? This overview. Stack grows downward, it grows upwards, you have different segment of the, how does it means once you compile your code into the binary, you get different sections, right? So this is the heap. So high address. Right now, the high address is where the from high top to down, your heap grows. In between, you have dynamic library that is shared across all the program that runs on your system because it does not have to copy. Then heap grows from the downwards. So this is the live program. This is the live running code in the memory. If you look into it here, you have the lowest address corresponding to your heap. And this is the highest address from high to down, it corresponding to this stack. In between, you have different library associated with the Linux. So there is actually, once we talk about this, this is your program looks, how program looks inside the running memory.
What is this representation? Like, what do you mean? Like you said, heap grows upwards and then stack grows downwards, right? This is a direct representation of that, or how did you get this?
Okay, so this is the direct representation of that, and every on the Linux, I'm not familiar with the Windows, literally I hate Windows to even shut down Windows. Just think about UI interface to even shut down Windows, you click on start button. That's it. Means people talk about UI interface and design. So this is the on the Linux machine. I'm not familiar with the Windows, sorry guys. So on the you have a proc mem information. Every proc ID has the memory information, CPU info, everything on set the Linux. So on this you see, okay, where does my program start? It starts at some lower address. This is the lower address. This actually stores my binary. Binary gets stored where? BSL text section, right? You have text section on the lowest side. Then you have the heap running on the heap side. So heap is start at the lowest address too. So right now heap is just for this much. And your this is the highest address. So in between you have some library call, and then you heap is start at your 7FF high address, and then it will grow downwards. So your what happens once your program runs, right? So how does virtual, what is the means fundamental concept of virtual memory? It says that every process will have its own virtual memory that the operating system supports. So my okay, Linux currently does not support all the virtual memory till 64 bit. Even though my address line is 64 bit, it supports 48 bits only. So your addressable bytes that you can get on the Linux is 48 bits only. So that concept, plus they put on some limitations over there also. You can actually have the RAM on the consumer grade that can only grow till 128 GB. After that, no matter how much RAM you put, it does not matter to them. Any question in this?
So 64 of these architectures support 128 GB of RAM.
Linux, yes. Currently, Linux version only support that. Means on the consumer side, you have a AIX system from the IBM and all. They goes much higher than that, but my laptop, I don't know, I will need ever 128 GB in near future. Two things. Also, once we talk about the heap, how does the heap grow, right? There has to be certain thing that the heap grows. So on the system level, there is something known as star break and break point. Each virtual memory has to add level like this. Start, break, and the break, top break. So once you want to actually increase your heap memory, you have to modify this break point of your virtual memory. This break point is what increases your heap to the level. Okay. If you are trying to get everything, I know it's this is completely translated into blog post in much details. I will share you the link of the blog post. And if you are familiar with the Go Weekly, you might have seen this article in the Go Weekly or if also. So no need to worry about if where is the slides and everything. If I'm not, because due to time limitations, I cannot cover each and every point in details over here. So this breakpoint is what you increase. Now think this way. How many, every process has its one virtual memory, right? So once we talk about virtual memory, how many two thread manipulating this breakpoint at once? What will be the state of your entire process? You cannot say deterministically, means it's the factor which you cannot say in details that, okay, one thread is going to modify from this position to this position and another is modifying from this position to this position. You cannot determine because the CPU write does not happen also because it has write buffer and all those things. So you will be like, your program will be in the undeterministic state and you will get something. Sometimes it can corrupt your memory. That's why most of the memory allocator, when you design your memory allocator, what do you say? It cannot be, you cannot have the parallel allocator at, no matter what you do, you cannot write a parallel allocator, memory allocator. It has to be serialized. All the threads has to be serialized. That's why designing a memory, look, once you write, that's why once we talk about malloc and all, these problems comes when you write a code that is not means concurrent to run in a safe way to allocate memory. That's where most of the bugs comes in. Now, second thing, at the this is the lowest level you can get, right? How many times you have seen that, how do you say that every thread that needs to allocate memory, it has to increase, right? So let's suppose I have a 10 request coming in. For every request, I want to increase. So it's sort of saying system call for each 10 request, and every thread has to block for that particular thing. So this is serialization plus blocking at the global state for your entire process. Once we will see for the Go memory allocator also, how does they try to avoid this kind of global locks at the fundamental level from ground. Now, once we talk about virtual memory and all, we know that what kind of virtual memory is what. So page frame and pages, those are two different concepts altogether. How many of you have ever debugged the code and found that the heap size that program shows is large and RSS size is completely different? Apart from the Windows, because everything on the Windows maps to the same.
I didn't debug, but in the end,
you got to know, right? RSS size is what your program actually using the memory. RSS is resident set size. In Java, I'm not very much familiar with the Java, but yes, in the Java also you get these things. RSS in the heap dump also you will see RSS size different than the total heap consumption. So your virtual page space, virtual memory space, right? It starts from the whatever addressable bits you have. Let's suppose for 48 bit, it can access up to 128 GB. It's divided into the pages. Now, page size is something that you can control by default on the consumer laptop like this. It's the 4 KB. So this RAM, whenever you want to access, actually access the, any memory, means any variable, any object that is stored at that particular page, it is get stored that page. If not found in the RAM, means in the page frame, RAM also has something known as the frame, page frame. What is the page frame? Think about the, in a simple term, you have a photo frame, right? Until unless you put a photo, it's a blank. There is nothing. So, but the size is fixed, right? You cannot put, if the, you got a photo frame, you cannot put anything that is larger than the, that photo frame allows. The same thing happens with the RAM. This page frame size is something that operating system sometimes decide, but most of the time you can also configure, but most time it's 4 KB to 8 KB. Different page frame, there are different page frame size. For our case, we will consider only 4 KB. So let's suppose I am trying to access this page, means not page, we are trying to access one variable which has been written on that page. What will happen if that page is not present in the RAM? What will happen for the OS side? You will get a page fault. Now it's the job of the OS to load that page into the RAM, because you cannot access anywhere things. It has to be in the RAM. Operating system will load that page into the page frame, and then you can access the initializes variable, whatever you are doing, it will happen through that. The swap space, if you have means ever install Linux manually, you have to say that, okay, I want this much of swap space. That basically means I want that page, once this RAM is full, and if another process triggers a page fault and there is no page frame means empty over there, that page will be swapped to that disk. I talked about increasing the breakpoint, right? So here is the simple assembly code I can show to you, because, okay, let me increase the phone. visible? Simple. Why I wanted this to be shown, because once you go to the any higher programming language like C or Java or anything, you don't get the concept of the how do you actually increase the breakpoint, because once you have the malloc, and most of the time it takes care so many things behind the scene that you actually do not get the notion what is happening behind the scene. So this is the assembly. Anyone writing assembly code? So this is the what happens for this. Let's go this way there. For this assembly code, what I'm doing is, so 12 is the system call number. So every operating system has their own system call number that operate, that correspond to certain operation. So this is the ISA instruction set specific, right? So this only works on the Linux, plus it assumes GAS means GNU assembly language structure only. So there is NAS and all those structures. So this is for that. What I'm saying is move. Okay. What it means by, and I will try to put down, this is the immediate value. I'm trying to put the 12 value on the register RAX. Once you do any system call, two things happens on the assembly level. It takes the value from the first, it takes the number, what is the system call number from the RAX register, and it returns the value to RBX. So RBX is nothing, you have seen A register AX, BX, CX. So on that was designed for the 16-bit. For 32-bit, they named it EX, EBX, because it's extended. For 64-bit, it becomes RAX, really extended. I don't know 128-bit what they do. So once you put down this 12 number, that becomes, I'm calling the break, system call of break. Put that value in the RAX register. And then, okay, forget about this one. This is larger part of the code where I actually write the hello world on, put down everything. And then I call a system call, syscall, right? So it will give, what it will give? Okay, I'm giving the RA12 and RAX. Give me the starting point of the, where the break actually right now, break is actually pointed in the virtual memories. Then, oh, leave this one. Now, what I did, these are two, RDI and RSI are two, how do you pass argument at the assembly level? So these are two registers. What I got this current break point, right? Where actually it's pointing, I made it the current address, I passed into the argument register, RDI. And then I increment the RDI by 4 bytes. And then again, I made the system call with the, again, I put that 12 value over here, and then said whatever value RAX has, and then put the system call. So RAX syscall over here, initially, if you see RDI value was 0, right? Here I put the 0 value. I didn't want it to put anything. Here I'm putting the RDI value increased by the whatever current is the 4. So that's how you increase the, this system call will increase the your breakpoint at the assembly level. Okay. So once you do this memory, now you, we know every time we want to increase the memory allocation, means increase the heap size of the process, we have to actually do the system call. Fundamental goal of the any memory allocator you design at the higher level language, the fundamental principle is to avoid so many system calls. How do, that's the enough thing. So one of the major thing, not enough, one of the major thing you should be considering when you are designing any kind of memory allocator for anything. This is the MMAP threshold you can get from the malloc library. It's currently set to the, if you do not provide, it means even though you are requesting for 4 bytes of memory or 12 bytes of 12 kilobytes, it will by default gives you 128 kilobytes. If it's not larger than that, it will, means it will increase the heap breakpoint till 120 from whatever is the current to 128 kilobyte, and then fulfill your request for the memory. Okay, second thing. memory fragmentation. We all have dealt with this, right? Windows 98, 2000, run fragmentation. Okay. So memory fragmentation, there are two kinds of fragmentation, internal and external. Internal fragmentation is something we'll see, means it does not matter right now for us because it's too much of detail to be going to for internal, but yeah. For external fragmentation, it's easier to grasp with the external fragmentation. Let's suppose I have this long block of memory over here. I do a malloc and I took a 4 byte of it. Okay. I took a 4 byte of it. I again took a 5 byte of it. So this is the simple incremental, means sequential bump allocator. It simply moves the pointer from one position to another position. And then again, I did a 6 allocation. Now I freed the pointer, whatever the memory location I have that P2, whatever I got. So I freed the position at 5 blocks. Now I want to request for the 6 block. It cannot be fulfilled because every request has to be continuous block of memory. So what you have got over here is the external fragmentation. This memory location is fragmented. This memory location is fragmented. Now, once we talk about Java and all systems, Java has to deal with such systems because they didn't have this sophisticated memory allocator when it was designed, and later they cannot change the API because it was used so many places. So so many things come into picture when you are so much into market and then you cannot do something about it. So that's where the generational garbage collector comes into picture. Not generational compact. They move memory because of this factor only. Why? They move memory from one generation to another generation. Two things for the Java, as far as I know, that concerns them. And why Go is opposite of that? Okay, Go also, there is popular notion that Go does not have a generational garbage collector. Go did try generational garbage collector. What Go does not have is a compactness. They do not want to compact because once we will see in the future slides that why this thing does not come into play into the Go memory allocation part. Now for the Java part, you have seen, right? You move it from one place, first from what they call it, Eden space, right? Young generation to the survival generation something. So they move from one space to the another space so that they can have the compact. So let's suppose for this example, here they cannot access future, they cannot allocate the memory any further. So what they do, okay, they will trigger a minor GC because they want the period to be very short. So the concept over there is like, we will do GC in minor pauses instead of the one longer pause. So that the pause time, you want your application throughput to be very large, right? So you can, so there is queuing theory over there, means queuing theory concept that says you cannot achieve both latency and throughput at the same scale. Means either you sacrifice certain amount of latency to attain certain amount of threshold, or you sacrifice throughput to attain certain amount of latency. So minor GC. So it will move this point, whole block of memory. It will move this whole block of memory. Now your memory is compact, right? You can actually assign that memory, whatever is the leftover, to another block. Two things also here, you will see that while moving this, you have to actually chase down the pointers. Chase down pointers means you should actually know which pointer is pointing to which memory. You cannot, means the reference has to change, right? This is will be pointing to certain virtual address. Now, once you move it from one virtual space to another virtual space, this P1 is allocated and P3 is allocated. It has to be referenced to another virtual space. So this pointer has to be maintained. It's a strict condition of the anytime you want to do compact GC. TCmalloc. So there is something known as the TCmalloc. It's developed by the Google. I don't remember the exact year, but it was something around 2004 or 2002. What the concept, what they say over here is, okay, instead of giving you the whole block of virtual, means entire virtual memory to you and you deal with it, what we will do is, we know that the each object size has to be rounded up to this sum, means we will divide the entire block of memory you gave it to us in certain blocks. What are the blocks? It's not a power of two. Don't get it that it's the power of two. It's not a power of two. So the fundamental thing they try to achieve is the fragmentation should be within the limit of 12.5%. So from one block to next block, if I do a division, the fundamental reduction in the fragment, it should not exceed ever 12.5% of the total memory that I get. So what they say is, I have a 8-byte, I have a 16-byte blocks, I have a 32-byte blocks, I have 48-byte blocks, so on till 256-byte of blocks, KB of blocks. So what they say over here is, if you need any memory which can fill into 8-byte of blocks, you get memory from that part block only. So it is mentioned as a free list. So there are different concept also, right? Buddy system, free list, segregated free list. So this is segregated free list in a sense. Every block has been segregated separately. All the blocks has been segregated separately, and then you have a block maintained as a linked list. Free list is nothing but a linked list version. So you have a linked list where each block points to the another block. Now, what are the benefits you get out of this? You can utilize first fit algorithm to find which blocks I can. First fit means, let's suppose I'm searching for the 8-bit over here. I'm searching for the 8-byte of memory over here. I can simply transverse from here, which is the first free block I can allocate, means I can allocate dump whatever I have, I currently want to write and over there. But with the other system, you once the memory is over there, right, you have to actually, you cannot use first fit. Why? It also leads to your so much of memory fragmentation. Reason being, let's suppose you want 8 bits of memory to be allocated, and the first block you actually encounter is 256 kilobyte. Since it fits over there, it will give you that block, but you wasted so much memory over there. So that is, so for that to avoid, they use something known as the best fit algorithm. You can think of the this best fit as, okay. In the array, if I tell you, how do you find, if I have the first, means I give you certain number, I tell you that find me if there is any element that is lowest than this, means you have to transfer entire array, right? And then you keep a variable check, if this is less than that, this is less than that, this is less than that, and then you give me that. The same kind of concept is the best fit. At the, if you want to visualize, that is the thing. Now, with this, what they did was, for every once you want to have the memory, every thread will get one copy of this. So what it meant once you gave one copy of this? Till this level is not, means any block is available in this, you can satisfy n number of requests from this block itself, then rather going to the increase the process at the global level. You can satisfy from here itself. Larger, so they have this 256 kilobytes, and the larger heaps memory allocation is satisfied from the global cache. So that's why they have something thread cache. This is known as the thread cache. Now we'll move to the Go memory allocator. Two things. Go memory allocator is roughly based on this concept, but it has diverged quite a lot, just roughly based on this concept itself.
Sorry, I just had one question.
Yes.
Just to close the loop, in the previous one, we allocated memory wherever we find it, and then when we create, we have to compact it so that we get more memory. But here, let's say I need, 32 bit. You're searching in first 8-byte thing. Would it allocate 1 8-byte and then 1 16 and something like that, or it goes for to find the 32-bit?
So, okay. So there is one more, once you ask for the memory, right? So there is two things that happens. Your every memory is aligned to certain memory X. So you cannot have like, I want 23 bytes of memory to be, there are two things from the perspective of hardware also. It's not hardware cache friendly because it has to, it if it's over here, you have this block. Let's suppose this is two complete block. Not from this, this is two complete block of RAM. So cache size is 64 byte, right? So if I have this, I allocate from this 2 byte and if I need and this 2 byte, what will happen? You have to actually do two. It cannot fit into one cache because that's the two different aligned memory. So it has to do two reads. So there is things it tries to first, it tries to whatever memory allocation you try to do, it tries to find the nearest where it can be aligned. Nearest memory means value that can be aligned. So that's why they have this concept of 8, 16, 32, 48, so that it can be aligned to the cache line. So anytime you do a memory read, it does not have to, means a CPU cycle, once you talk about CPU cycle, right? Assembly language, I put the instruction like move something. At the CPU cycle, you will think, okay, this will be atomic, right? Move something, but it is not atomic even for the read perspective. Each CPU instruction means ISA instruction itself goes through 6 phases. That is means that is derived through the clock, finite state machine. Fetch, in fetch, decode, load address. I forgot one, but store, execute and store. Those are the 5. So each is driven by the clock. So every time you write, right? So that's where the parallelization comes into picture at the CPU level. Once you talk about that. You cannot guarantee, once I talked about, right, you cannot guarantee which memory, which thread will write it first, because CPU tries to prefetch instructions from different cycles also. If it has moved over there, it will try to prefetch instruction from the next cycle also. And then it will, it has its own buffer where it will execute, and whichever instruction execute first, it will try, that will be written. There are a way to avoid that? Yes.
I understand this thing. Earlier we had allocation only in a continuous series, continuous block.
Mm.
How does this linked list kind of pattern map to that?
Okay.
Because the memory is still contiguous.
Yes.
So it's not stored as a linked list.
Yes. Yes.
How does allocation
okay. work? So what is the memory that you have over there? You have at pages, right? You have page, 4 KB page. So let's suppose I get 4 KB page. It's up to me now to, I can divide those 4 KB pages according to my need. Earlier, it was given, the entire 4 KB was given to you and the memory allocator was simple bump pointer. I allocate 1 byte, I will just increase pointer 1 byte. I allocate 2 bytes, I will just increase pointer 2 bytes. Now here what they say, instead of doing that, what I am doing is that 4 kilobytes of pages I have divided into a block and then maintain a list of such blocks within my application state itself. So whenever I am trying to assign, get any memory for that particular size, I will go to that block which is free and allocate it over there. Does this make sense?
So probably I'll add onto the question. So earlier the problem was you freed some memory and yes. Then now you have 2 bytes in a different place and then 4 bytes in a different
place.
So if you want 6 bytes, you can't allocate, but still you have allocated.
Yes.
But in here also the same case, right? I can have a 16 byte memory in some place and 32 byte in another place. So now if I want some bytes, does it allocate 2 different lists and then you can traverse it? Or like, because even fragmentation can, is the same case, right? So how does it happen? Do I still need one full chunk of memory? I need 64 bytes, then only I can give you 48 bytes. Or can it allocate 32 plus some 16?
No.
Okay.
So,
so we are reducing the fragmentation issue.
Yes.
We need a contiguous
memory. We still need a contiguous memory. So let's suppose here the 48 bytes is over, right? So to allocate next 48 bytes, it won't allow, even though all these are free, it will ask from the global means cache to give it to another 48 bytes of block of memory and then store. So it requests in a chunk, means it does not allocate for one means request. It will ask for in a bulk that, okay, I will put it in my cache and then
next 48 bytes I can satisfy from here.
So these block sizes, are they dynamic?
No, it's fixed. It's fixed. Next thing is, how does, okay, once you have the pages, right, not a 4 KB page, if you have something known as 8 KB memory, because the page size is 4 KB. So what they do is they make it, all the pages, they fit into an multiple consecutive pages and they call it as a span. And they have the list of, this is from, this span means a global list. Well, if this span is constituted of one page, this is not divided, it's still not divided. It's the simple large block of pages. So this is the from the TC malloc perspective. Let's, okay, before going, we all know this, right? This looks like crow scale, right?
This span is TC malloc scale, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes, like span and span and block size came from the TC malloc. So this is how we all know this, right? Go scheduler things. We might have seen somewhere how does Go scheduler works. So this is your system thread. M is your system thread. P is the logical processor that is provided at the Go runtime, and all your Go routings runs on map to the P. It never maps to the M directly. Means it actually runs on the M, but it maps to the, it's the job of the Go runtime to find a suitable free P or from to run it on the M. So this is something how Go means works from the scheduler perspective. Since this talk is not about the scheduler, where I will cut it out just to have you brief overview, because once I talk about MCAS and all, you will see this in exam. In Go, there are, to be exact, 67 different class sizes. Class size is nothing but the memory I talked about, right? Block size on what? So they have something known as from class sizes 0 to 32 kilobytes. So what it means by 0 to 32 kilobytes? Let's suppose also the pages at the Go level is maintained at the 8 kilobytes granularity. It's not 4 kilobytes. So once I talk about blocks, you get a 8 kilobytes of page, right? If I have, if I divide it into a block of 1 kilobyte, I will have total 8 such blocks over here. So this is the class size and how your pages are divided over here. So there are 67 such pages division happening over here. Second thing, when I talked about, you will say, how does Go knows means what is the page means how many pages constitute which block means how many pages to divide for each class size, right? So at max there have means they try to reduce everything to 12.5% of fragmentation. Not everything you can divide by within this class size. Okay, 144, let's pick 128 will be 144. If you divide 144 by 8 kilobytes, you will get certain remainder percentage. So likewise, so if you divide, even though you get this much of page remainder, it's a sort of fragmentation. So how many pages to divide into that class size, they have this number 12.5%. So at max they can have this. So at max for certain pages, for this, if I remember, that was for 28 kilobytes, 7 or 10 pages constitute this. And then divide it into, so you have 7 pages and then you divide it into 28 kilobytes of each. So this is the M-span structure I talked about, right? Span. Span actually manages the, means runs of pages into span. So here you have the all the pages divided into each block for that particular class size. Let's suppose we have 16 byte, we have 24 byte, we have 32 kilobyte. So accordingly for each class size, there will be a span size. And each span will have, so M span is something where this runs of pages is managed in the Go. M span is your double linked list. It maintains the pointer to the first span, to the last span.
Plus, it also have certain value. It means there are other fields also, but from our perspective, these three are important. Span class, a start address, and end pages. So I have 4 kilobytes of page. I divided it by the, let's suppose, 32 bytes memory. What is the total number of what is the start address of that, right? You have that start address. Now once you want to allocate to the next, it will also maintain the things, how many allocation has happened, so that free index also, at what point the next free index is, and also certain thing like alloc pick and all those things come into garbage collection. But for that, they maintain start address, free index. So next time you want to allocate, it will directly go to that free index and get the that object size from that position. So this is the M span. So this M span is what manages your page in the Go. This M span structure does not leaves itself. It leaves inside the M cache. I talked about, right? Each Go routine runs on its own logical processor P. So this logical processor P, now let's suppose we have something, Go routine wants to get the memory allocation fulfilled. Instead of going for the global, it will try to fulfill from something which P has, that is known as the MCAS. So what MCAS? First thing to note, since each P can only run one Go routine, you cannot have multiple Go routines running on each P, right? Likewise on the thread also, you cannot have multiple functions running, you can only run one function. So what happens, you avoided the lock at global state, you don't have to deal with lock over here, because it's the only one deterministic Go routine running over there that can only get access to the memory over there. Second thing, so I talked about there are 67 classes, but here once you see, I write that there are total 134 such span class block. Why? It's to deal with the garbage collection. If I have object, I have two kind of object. Object can contain the pointer inside it, object which does not contain pointer inside it. Think from the garbage collection perspective, since every garbage collection has to, based on this garbage collection is on the Go, is based on the mark and sweep, right? Tracing garbage collector. If you avoided any trace, means marking phase, any marking and tracing to object which does not have the pointer, you actually means avoided so many marking and tracing cycles, right? You don't have to deal with it. So for that reason, Go has two things. It also maintains object which has to be scanned during the GC cycle, object which do not have to be scanned during the cycle. So it's scan and no scan. So if you have 32 byte of block, there will be two such M-span structure over there. That M-span structure will be scan, another will be no scan. So if you have an object that does not contain any pointer, it will be stored over the no scan things. Then there is tiny allocator. So stack has also comes into from this only. So same thing Go, the stack is resizable, right? The stack means can grow in from 2 KB to up to the limit imposed by the operating system, that is our limit of the 8 MB. So once the stack has also gets its memory in the same way, it's just that the structure is a bit different. They are more compact into to form that structure. So we will not talk about the stack as, because concept of its own, and it will means it will take so much time to cover things. So if you look over here, the tiny allocator, what it says is
holistic, is like more variable in the past or more recursive variable. The bigger the state is.
Stack. The bigger the stack, the
allow.
Okay, what is the benefit? If you think about that benefit, how does, let's suppose you have 2 kilobytes of stack starting up, right? Now you want the stack is growing from the 2 kilobytes to the 3 kilobyte. You don't have memory, right? So right now, previously Go has something known as this segmented stack. What it means by one part of the stack lives in this memory, another part it will just point to the another memory. Now it's something known as the, it completely copies the stack from one memory location to the bigger memory location. So you are actually copying the whole memory, stack memory from one position to the another position. So that copy has the incurring cost. So if you care about latency, something known as people are developing in the Go memory pool, stack pool, right? So they have something they allocate. It's the concept of the thread pool. You do not get memory benefit. It's just that the allocation comes at a cost. This allocation is not something free. You are avoiding the allocation cost upfront.
So when a function stack, it has two variables. It will go to the stack for that function.
Yeah.
And the stack is first restrained with some 2 KB. Now that function look at more local variable. The stack has to be expanded.
Yes.
So first you will copy the existing stack to the new one.
Yes.
To bigger stack and then allocate the rest of the variables.
Yes. So it's like once you exit, so there is something in the Go stack frame guard. So once you try to reach that stack frame guard, so it's like a stack function call, right? Function can only allocate a stack. So once you reach that Go's runtime sees that you are trying to hit that any allocation, you hit that frame guard, but it will pause and it will copy the entire to the bigger stack. And that stack is not something that grows static, it's something that grows dynamically. So let's suppose you achieved something, you hit the 2 KB stack frame guard. So the next copy will be to the 4 KB. Yeah. But if you hit the within that same call, if you hit the 4 KB limit and it says that even though you need 16 KB, but the next will be copied to the 8 KB until unless, because it does not have a JVM sort of thing, it cannot observe and continue observing and beforehand and do the pre-allocation. JVM has its own advantage, JIT. So let's talk about the timing allocator. Any allocation that is happening that is less than the 16 byte, that goes to timing allocator. Why? I need 1 byte of memory. Should I allocate in the 8 byte of the block? No, right? Because why? I wasted 7 byte of memory over there. So with the lower number, it's more of you get the it's not about fragmentation, it's about memory wastage. So Go has this tiny allocator. If your memory requirement is less than the 16 byte and it does not contain pointer, that is the one thing. Anyway, you cannot satisfy pointer because your pointer becomes the space address, either 32 or 64 byte. So that anything that does not have pointer and is less than the 16 bit of memory, it will be allocated to the tiny allocator. So tiny allocator does all this, means it sort of your bump pointer itself, but it maintains another few variables and all those things. Since each P has this, you don't have to do the locking. Any object size in Go that is up to the 32 kilobytes will be satisfied from your MCache only. Any object that is larger than the 32 kilobytes, so when you do profiling in Go, I haven't done much of the profiling in Go because I don't work with the group protection system. But whatever I've done in the free time, anytime you see anything exceeding 32 kilobytes of memory, you will see that it's where, if you do memory allocation profiler, you will see where exactly it's stored. You will get, it's actually stored in the MHIP, not in the MCache. So in some point of time, you will see that the MCache has failed, right? It needs to get another spam. So from where does this MCache gets its another spam? So Go has something that is known as the MCentral. MCentral does not actually store the spam. It's just maintaining a list of the free blocks of spam and what spam has been allocated as a pointer. So once you have that, so it will ask from the MCentral to refill this MSPAN structure from say that. So it has something. So there are two things in the MSPAN. Now MSPAN also, if you look over here, MSPAN also has the span class and there is lock involved. Now what it means by the, if you look over here, the thing is, out of four go routine, only one can achieve this lock, right? But the concept here is for each MCentral, for each span class, you have another MCentral. So if two go routines need memory and that cannot be fulfilled from the MCache, what it will do, and if those two go routines are requesting for different size class, that can be satisfied parallelly without serializing, because each MCentral has two different, for each span class you have another MCentral. So MCentral is simply maintaining the list of the non-empty and the empty. So once you try to empty means that MSPAN is completely object, there is no free object inside that MSPAN. So once you request the any object, means any MSPAN from the MCache, it will get that MSPAN from the non-empty, and that relationship is like based on certain number of object that is freed from that page, means object page freed from that MSPAN, it will be either put into the MSPAN or sorry, empty and non-empty. Okay, now comes the heap. So this is your heap. Heap has something global lock. So this global lock, anytime you deal with the heap, from the central heap, object larger than the 32 kilobytes, or you have some, every pages that you have allocated runs out, it needs more pages from the operating system. That's where the global locks comes into the picture. That is the only time where global allocation happens. And in Go, you do not assign, means in the 64-bit operating system, you do not get memory in one byte. Or it right now, it's 64 MB of memory that you get in the chunk. Since in the Linux, until unless that page is touched, it does not translate to the actual physical RAM that you are using. So they allocate the entire virtual space of the 64 kilobyte. But since Windows has this problem, anything you request, you actually commit it to the RAM. So they have this small size of 4 MB of. Only take 4 MB in a chunk from the operating system. So it also has the MCentral maintains this for each span classes, this MCentral cache. Then you have for larger spaces, anything larger than the 32 kilobytes, it is stored in the, it has the number of pages that constitute. This means it again store the MSPAN list of the pages. So each pages will be constituted again from this max heap limit is actually 128. So once the pages size, any allocation that needs more than the 127 pages, constitutive pages, it will be stored into something known as structure mTrip. It's a sort of a binary tree where, and then this corresponding to that, you get a busy large and the DGMSPAN that only maintains the metadata, which span is free, means like in the MCache, MCentral, right? You have two lists, one maintaining where this is, if this is span is free or not, and then from where to satisfy the next request. The same way you have this. So this is the object allocation. Anything less than the 16 kilobyte, anything less than the 16 byte will be allocated to the tiny cache. Less than the 32 kilobyte, it will be satisfied from the MCache itself without having any sort of lock, because it's the P, that MCache is attached to the P. And then anything greater than the 32 kilobytes, you have to go to the central heap. So if you have seen Go, why Go does not need two things. Go does not need compact because of the way it allocates the memory, right? It avoids the fragmentation. It does not have to deal with the fragment because the every fragment allocation details, it's like 12.5%. At max, you can have the fragmentation. So it tries to avoid all sort of things that have means that kept him from the memory allocation that was done, means malloc and all those library had the problem. That's why Go is not somewhere you will see. Generational garbage collector is possible, but right now they did a search on this generational garbage collector also, but it was not means giving a factor where they can say, okay, we will go move ahead with the generational garbage collector. The last thing is, yes.
This B is this logical processor, which Go understand.
P is the logical processor on which your Go routine runs. Yeah.
But then why there is a relationship between this logical processor and memory? Because my Go routine running on P1, it will resume if it is doing some network call. It will go to the waiting, and this the same Go core routines. Next time when it gets the opportunity, it will go to the P2 logical processor, depending on the scheduling. Then this Go routine, which was created in P1, now it is running in P2, and the memory allocation has happened in the P1. Now.
Okay. If you
confusion, right?
Okay. So if you look into the network scheduler part, the network pooler does not say that it will go to the P2. It has certain affinity with the P. It also maintains the affinity until unless it necessary. It will move that every allocation from this point to the next memory. All the object will be moved from this. That's why it attends every go routine has the affinity to for certain P on which it's running.
So if possible, Go will always make sure that once a Go routine attaches to one P, which is P1, it will always try to put that Go routine on the P1 only.
Yes. Plus, once you have this memory allocation happening on this P also, since virtual only one virtual space, right? You are allocating on the same virtual page, right? So that memory location can be only accessed by this coroutine only. So you are not corrupting that memory location even. Even though it's running on the another location, that memory location is still valid to that P coroutine only. The another P routine. So it has the scheduler make sure that these sort of things happen. Plus, if it has to really move, it moves from one P to another P.
But then there is also possibility that one memory location is actually accessed by Go routine 1 and Go routine 2. And Go routine 1 and Go routine 2 are in the different P.
So that is the possibility. That's why this is the heap, right? It can be accessed by multiple Go routine. It's your job to protect that through either through synchronization of the channel or through mutex.
Yeah, data algorithm.
Then what is
problem? We can actually
take
it afterwards.
Okay, so I will talk briefly about the virtual space since I'm running out of time. No. Okay, then virtual space in the Go. So once you have this virtual, let's suppose this is the simple Go program. I have not done anything. It's a simple infinite loop running. If you look into the virtual size of Go, it's 100 MB. The resident size is still less, but it's the 100 MB. It's a Go 11.5. It might change. This is not something you should take as a granted. Earlier, it used to be 512 GB, believe me. So, not believe me, just download the code Go 1.7, 1.6 and see. So why this such a difference, right? So if you look into here, there is the Go process, running process. You will see three spaces that actually constitute much of the memory. One is 64 MB, second is 32 MB, and one is 2 MB. So this is something where Go GC comes in. Means these data, I told you, right? Go always takes memory in 64 MB from the operating system. So 64 MB is something you, it makes sense, right? But this 32 MB and 2 MB is something that, from where does this comes into picture? So for Go, there is for every blocks, So for this, every arena, they maintain a metadata known as the GC bitmap and the span. So for bitmap, they point it to the bitmap actually for each word point, means word location. Like for 64 bit, it will be 64 bit. It maintains two things, whether there is an object, means whether this should be scanned. So once you have the struct, I will show you. Once you have the struct, so it maintains two things, whether it's a pointer or it should be scanned further or not. So, okay, this is the last slide. So this, I'll show you lit. Okay. So if you have a something like this, rather than once I talk about bitmap, okay, so it maintains for each object that you have allocated that whether this object should be scanned further or not. So the difference between these two will be the GC scan pressure. So in this, it maintains the bit saying that this object should be stopped scanning after this B has off, because there is no, after that there is no pointer to it. But with this, it cannot, means let's suppose you have another field, 10 field, and then you have put down the pointer. So it will say that it cannot, so it will scan the entire field. So it's more of a latency GC scan. It should not taken as like, you should write your code for the readability, but if you are hitting that limit of latency and all those things, do keep this, consider this in mind that such things.
All pointers should be first.
Current, with the current implementation, yes, but it's changing frequently. So you read the Go source code. And with that, we have, this is the last slide, just for the means demo how this actually happens. Means the just the summary overview. And if you want to read more about it, I will share the link in the chat. So you can, the entire thing that I have talked about, means if you find any, means if you have any questions, shoot out to me on the, anywhere you find me. Plus you can read everything from top to bottom over here. It's in much more detail over here. Means little bit of more detail that I can cover it over here. So that's it from my side. Thank you. Any questions? Yes.
So how do you compare the performance of JVM garbage collection and memory allocation versus the one that we
talked about? Okay. I'm not a performance engineer in terms of the GC. I have never written any means garbage collection algorithm, but think this, the what means whatever the in the public domain we think can think of. Think this way, what GC over there says is, we will have the sort process and for the any allocation, what this is for the short pauses we have, we will pause the application, entire application for a small duration in n number of times, and then we will do a major garbage collection based on the survival. I think number of times this object has survived, put it into the means hidden survival space somewhere they put it, second space younger old generation somewhere they put, right? And then the larger means pause time, full GC happens when that becomes full, it cannot allocate. What Go says is, since in the Go this garbage collection runs in the parallel in a sense, the mutate, there is two concept in the, once you deal with the garbage collection, anytime you read mutator and the collector means one thing, mutator, collector and the allocator, we talked about allocator, right? So mutator is the code that mutates the state of the object graph. Heap is sort of a object graph, right? One virtual memory pointing to means location to another, you can have the edges, so it's, we call it object graph. This object graph, anything that modifies that object graph is known as the mutator. Anything that tries to free up read those mutator means object graph is known as the collector. So once you have this mutator collector concept, so anytime, let's suppose on this I have four virtual CPU. On this system, four virtual CPU, and if Go max proc is four, that means there are four multi-thread, anything not running, let's suppose, four thread that is running any point of time, right? So you have this four thread running over there, three will be the mutator, if one will be the collector, if garbage collection comes in. So for that collector, what it will do, it will have multi, instead of doing the pause over there, it will, what it says in the Go, I will not do the multi short pauses like that, I will do a full pause, but since three collect mutators are already running in the concurrently in the parallel, that one collector can only pause for the, right now it's the 5 microseconds. That 5 microseconds happens in two phases, not the complete, it happens in the two phases. Since the mutator, it has to block all the mutator to get the root object, right, from all the P. So that P, and the second time is again validate that all the invariant, there is no invariant pointing from the black shaded object to the white shaded object. So that's where the performance means, if you are, have one only thread running, JVM will beat you. But if you have multiple thread run, means multiple core processor, it still performs as per as JVM. That is the only thing I means can give you a logical answer. Other than that, please explore and do let me know.
If you run Go with one thread and Java with one thread, then Java will beat Go.
Yes. But in the GC part.
In the GC part only.
Yes. Other than that, you can see there is no way to write a good code, no way to write
actually
a bad code.
Because Go does this micro GC and Java does this micro GC,
yes.
And Go does not do that.
It has to actually block all the P for that process. So if you have an infinite row and after that infinite loop, right, you manually call Go runtime GC. You will see your program actually freezes because it cannot block that, because Go runtime cannot preempt him. So,
but there is scope the word in Go. Also.
Yes,
but it is less.
No, it's not less.
It is there.
It's actually doing it in a concurrent way.
But
so you do not observe.
The there is not scope the word.
Okay. Stop the world in a concurrent way means your three mutator threads are not stopped for 5 microseconds in the whole, but is stopped in the two different phases for the 5 microseconds. So it is stopped for 2.5 microseconds and another phase it is stopped for the 2.5 microseconds. Let's keep that number in simple. So what happens for that to in between? So GC will, let's suppose GC is running for 50 microseconds, but you get for that 5 microseconds only this three thread is blocked, right? But once you talk about JVM pause, the entire pause, it has to pause, longer pause time means it has to, it won't run even in concurrently. It will pause the entire application in the longer GC.
So in Go, 50 microseconds takes for one collector, one GC.
5 microseconds.
For example, if it is taking 50 microseconds, okay. Then out of that, 5 microseconds, will be post of the word.
Yes.
In two phases.
Yes.
For those three mutators.
Yes. For entire means whatever mutator you are running.
Thank you so much again, Ankur. I think that is a very thorough research, and then you put up the plan. You wouldn't appreciate it like if you didn't have the questions of like, hey, why is no compaction? How is the GC time lesser? Like, definitely the GC time is much lesser than the other languages. So all this, I guess if you're new, please go explore, and then if you again come back to this video, you can really answer. Thank you very much for the talk.
Channel talks and then basic stuff. Now we are getting the core stuff. I think we should read and then like get to know more. So this talk is by Kishan and then hash tables. So all to you.
Yes.
Awesome. Okay, so I'm Kishan. I am a member in open source organization called like IPFS. I am employed by a company called Protocol Labs, and I'll be talking about peer-to-peer.
Are you able to hear?
It's pretty soft.
Okay, I'll. Okay.
You can use the mic.
Okay. Hello. It's good now. Audible? Okay. So I'm Kishan. I'm a member in an open source project called like IPFS. I am employed by a company called Protocol Labs, and I'll be talking about peer-to-peer how and Kademlia. So a few meetups back, I had a talk on IPFS. So generally, whenever we have like people throw ideas about peer-to-peer systems, say BitTorrent or Ethereum, most people are confused that how are these things working? Like there's no centralized server, and how is this possible? And it's something which is also not talked about so much. There's enough literature, but I personally found it very difficult to find any nice talks or some blog or whatever. Okay, so we'll talk generally, and we'll start a bit about peer-to-peer system, what they are, how we'll start with some basic peer-to-peer system, and we'll grow from there, and we'll come to some advanced systems like what we see now. In Ethereum, BitTorrent, etc., what things are working in production and things that work well. I'm still audible, right?
Yep.
Okay. Second talk. How do I get rid of this thing?
You
can't?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So this is my second talk. Okay, so we'll just start with peer-to-peer system. So in general, what peer-to-peer systems are, so compared to your client server, where you are just client, you don't have so much power, and there's some server, you just talk to them, and they are this central authority or central point. In peer-to-peer system, there are no servers, no centers, but they're just different people like you. They have the same software installed as you have on your machine, and basically those different softwares talk to each other, and that way you get information. So whenever you want some information, you don't talk to a server, you just talk to the node which is right next to you, right? So all nodes are equal, there are no centers, and there's a network of nodes talking to each other, right? Some examples are IPFS, Ethereum, Bitcoin, or BitTorrent, Tor also. Any of you have heard of IPFS? Okay, oh, good. Okay. Cool. So we'll just start with the client server and how routing and those things are done, and how peer-to-peer system is different. So in client server, what you do is, let's say you want to go to IPFS website, you go to IPFS.io, your system internally, there's something called domain name system, right? It will give you an IP address. Like you don't have IP address, the system will give you IP address. How domain name system works is, so there are a lot of domain name servers. A lot of domain name servers. There's one root domain name server, and these things are like handled by some authority. Like, you know, there are professional people working on it and stuff. And it's a basically a database, like a database which is quite a lot, like probably the most hit database. Right? So there is some sort of centralization in there. So first domain name server that you talk to will mostly be your ISP, right? So your service provider, Airtel or Vodafone or whatever it is, right? And from there, if they don't have the information, so so your ISP will provide you some things like, okay, the IP of Google is this, IP of Facebook, like some things which are popular. They won't have all the information because there are so many different websites. If they don't have, they'll pass on to somebody else. So it's a hierarchical system, but in a lot of ways, this is also like there's centralization in this. So this hierarchical lookup, root is very critical in this, and this runs in very serious secure data centers. And this is this works well for like the system that we have right now, like client server, but it is not decentralized. If you want decentralized system, right, all of these things that which are mentioned here, they are not there in decentralized. Like you can't assume that your nodes are secure and like seriously secure, right? Having any critical node is not a decentralized system, right? So these DNS would just not work for decentralized systems. And what happens in peer-to-peer world is that you have a hash for whatever things that you want. For example, you want to talk to other person, right? So it's a other node. So node would have a hash, a node ID, or you want to have some file. Let's say you want to download Avengers. So Avengers would have some hash. So using that, you can download Avengers. So something on those lines, right? So these are hashes, and based on that hash, you want IP address. Now you don't want IP address based on website name, one based on the hash. This is the main difference. It's same in IPFS, it's same in Ethereum, BitTorrent, etc., etc. Okay, so peer-to-peer as overlay networking. So you have this general concept of networking, right? How IP works, right? So even though you have you get IP from the website using DNS, and then you from IP also you need to do routing. So there's naming in DNS, there's routing also. But now in peer-to-peer systems, there's a network working on top of it. These things like normal IP stuff, it's still there, but there's a one layer on above. So now your different nodes are routing among each other, and your different nodes, they are doing the naming as well. Right? So because this is one layer above that, so you can call it an overlay network on your IP that we have. Okay, so we'll start by what early peer-to-peer networks were. Very simple thing we can think about is, what we'll do is we'll have a central server, right? We'll have a central server, and it will have all the information about what information is where. Okay. We want some file, some song, say Despacito or whatever, right? So there'll be a song name or ID, which are implementation detail, doesn't matter. So some song name, and then your IP address where it is stored, right? And these things are not stored in central database. These things are stored in nodes, but there's a central database which has the information. So in a way, it is peer-to-peer, but still there's a central point of failure. So this was Napster. So one of the first the earlier peer-to-peer system. So the problem with Napster was, yeah, there's a point of centralization, right? You have to depend on this one server. Another thing is, which like people try to, or like when you develop a peer-to-peer system, you try to avoid is some legal centers, right? So because you are distributing movies and music for free, right? People won't like it. There are copyrights and stuff, and it's not legal. So if you want to take such things down, all you have to do is stop that server. Now, because there's a server, there's some company running it, and you can issue a subpoena on that company, which is exactly what happened in case of Napster, right? And if this this power is distributed among different nodes, you can't tackle this legally. You can't subpoena like everybody who is running a Tor node or Ethereum node or such a way, right? So now you want something which is peer-to-peer, like it does not have a centralization. So common system is flooding. Okay. You have a bunch of nodes. You don't have a central server. You just talk to the node which is right next to you. If they know stuff, they will reply you. If they don't know, they will send the same request to the nodes clean off, right? And so on and so forth. It's just flooding, right? You send request to everybody you know. It works. It's peer to peer, like completely peer to peer. It's not efficient. Okay. Then you had this different type of slight modifications. There's some sort of centralization. There's a system called Keza. So you have the super nodes. So now you don't have one center, but you have multiple centers. You have some super nodes which would have more information, and the normal nodes which would have data and stuff. Super nodes might have information about what is stored where or whatever. Right? So there you have now multiple point of centralization. It's better than current system, not perfect. Okay. So what are differences, right? So your flooding is like it's scales in some ways. Right? So if everybody, so in flooding you want some popular information, right? If everybody wants to watch Avengers, and you, if it is flooding, it is very likely that no people you know would have Avengers. It works well. But if you want something which is not so popular, some random movie which nobody has watched or something, it would be very difficult with this kind of system, and that's what you are optimizing for, right? So finding popular stuff works, local, fancy local query, those things you can do, but these rare things, it's not so good for them. Right? And how you optimize for all these things is structured overlays. Now structured layers. So flooding, there's no structure. You just randomly go around throwing requests. If you have some structure, then you can have some sort of pattern that, okay, this node does not know that. If this node does not have the information, it is very likely that all these other nodes would not have that information. So eliminating those things out. And there's some sort of pattern. And because of that, you can have very efficient operations. Right? And you would also be able to retrieve information which are not so popular. Right? Okay. I have some mixed up slides. So going to distributed hash tables, that's what they are structured overlays. So what's a hash table? Like most of you might know, but I'll still repeat. Hash table is a key value pair. Like user supplies a key and hash table will give you a value. Right? So normal operation, insert, lookup, delete, time complexity is big theta of one. Up about. So hash tables are not normal hash tables, they are very efficient. It needs more storage, but they're very efficient, right? And you want distributed hash tables. So they are, by name, they are distributed among the network. But distributed how? Some properties that you want. You want cheap operations, you want your insertion, deletion, cheap. You want your key movement cheap, right? So when you say a key movement, so say where is Avenger stored? So the Avenger is key. In reality, there will be a different like complex hashes. You want lookups cheap. Like very importantly, you want lookups cheap. So that's how you find rare things. Right? You want a small routing table because these are normal computers running things and they don't have so much data. So you want small routing tables and what will these distributed systems do? They will store resource location. So, I mean, you're asking something? Okay. No problem. So what these systems will do? They will store resource location. If they start storing the data itself, then again, it's not so efficient, right? If I start storing the entire movie, Avenger in the data, it's not so efficient. So it would store resource location instead of that. Okay. So one such example of structured overlay or distributed hash table is Kademlia. It is very widely used. It's used in, implementations might be different. Like everybody would have a slight modification in what they're using, but it's widely used. It's used in Ethereum. It's used in BitTorrent. It's used in IPFS. It's used in I2P, talks, so many things. So, we'll talk about some basic concept and then we'll try to dig deep into how Kademlia works and what it is. So One thing is your uniform ID space, this closeness, local view. So these are three main core ideas. What I mean by uniform ID spaces, you pick some range, right? And the keys that you pick or the node IDs that you pick. So there are two things. There are node IDs. So these are IDs given to nodes, individual machines. That's your identification. That's how you exist on a peer-to-peer network. And there are keys for files. And this has to be the same uniform ID space. You can have some sort of different implementation, and you can calculate them differently. I mean, how do I explain this? You make sure that those things work separately, right? So if you do that, then you can have same ID space. So in that case, it is okay if your file key or your node ID is same, but a little complex anyway. So one such address space would be SHA-256. Right? So these things always give you unique results. So every time you want to pick a node ID, so when you join the peer-to-peer network, you have to pick a node ID. So you pick a node ID, it has to be unique. When I say unique, given that any random person is creating a node ID for themselves, right, they would get a different node ID. So the node ID that you generate is always unique. How do you guarantee such a thing? If you are generating random numbers, it's very likely that somebody else who is generating random numbers will also have the same number. Right? How do you guarantee that? You can guarantee it if you have a huge range. So this range, which I have right now from 0 to 2 raised to 256 minus 1, it's a really huge range. So in that kind of range, if people are generating random numbers, it is very, very likely that two people cannot generate same number ever. Right. Yep.
So this will be even the seed of the random generator. You will take one of the value, which will be the seed for the random.
One of the value from where?
From out of this address space. One of the value will be
out of this address space. So we are not going into how these random things are generated, right? So that is how your hashes work. We just want this property of hash that every time you generate something, it is unique. Right? So this you just not need a random thing from a hash, right? So SHA-256, powerful hash. There are other things also like SHA-512 and whatnot, right? But you want some powerful hash with a huge range. So just to give an idea, this range, so 2 raised to 256. So it's almost equivalent, or probably more than that. It's equivalent to number of atoms in the universe. So and the universe is really big, so there'll be a lot of atoms. It's unlikely that this ever happens, right? Same thing we use for files and nodes. So same IDs are given, same hashes are used for nodes and files, right? Okay, so there's enough range. We already talked about it. It has to be unique. Okay, then closeness. Okay.
Can there be a conflict between files and nodes? Is that a problem?
That's what I talked about, right? Yeah. In between. So if you handle them differently, right? If there's a conflict, then it's okay. If you are handling them differently.
Okay.
But even if you are handling them similarly or differently, I mean, it's unlikely that there'll be a conflict.
Yeah, that's yeah. Totally different.
Yeah. Okay, then you have a notion of closeness. Now we have selected this uniform ID space. You need this notion of closeness, that how you determine whether two nodes are close or not, or a node or a file is close or not. Right? So you have some notion of distance and the different ways. One is so what we have picked up, what which is used in Kademlia, is exclusive OR. So you take two node. If you want the distance between two node IDs, you take exclusive OR or XOR of those two node IDs, or if you want distance between a file or key of a file, would be more appropriate, a key of a file and a node, you take XOR of those two things. Right? So why is XOR? There are some nice properties that you need for some nice distance function which satisfies all of them. One such is that with a triangular property, so which is right, if I have A, B, and C, then A, B plus B, C should always be greater than AC. Okay, that's a triangular property. It's a, you might have seen this in graphs or something. Should I repeat this triangular property? No?
I feel like I should bother about closeness.
So we want some pattern in our distributed hash table. We want pattern in how things are stored in nodes. Right? So that's why.
Right. If you start your node, if I start my node, you will get a different unique ID. And if you just see the closeness between my node and your node, that's what you will do with the closeness.
Yeah.
What will we do is
because
my unique ID is so random, your is so random.
Yeah, so it is likely that we would be very distant from each other, right? So I mean, these are parts. Now I will arrive to this later in the talk, but to give a general idea, right? So even if we are distant, right? If our ZOR of my node or your node, it's very large, like then I don't care about you. I don't store information about you. I store information only about things that are close to you. That's how this pattern would work. So I would somehow try to find nodes which are close to me. These are not geographical locations. Do I repeat triangular property? No.
What is it in relation to? Triangular property of what?
Okay, so for something to be a nice distance function, you need triangular property. Say you have three nodes, A, B, C, right? So now distance between A and B is AB. Distance between B and C is BC, right? Distance between A and C is AC, right? So if you go directly from A to C, that distance always has to be less than, like going through this different node, going through B. So that's the triangular property. Okay. So that's one key thing which has to satisfy and ZOR does. So it's a nice distance function that way. Yeah. So that's how you talk ZOR bitwise. XOR. You have 5, you have 3. So 5 is 0101, 3 0011, and your ZOR is if two things are same, you give 0. If things are different, you give 1. So you have 0110, which is 6. So now you see how this distance is different than Euclidean distance. Right? So if we take Euclidean distance, that would be 2 and 5 and 3. But now this is 6. Right? Does not matter. All we want is some sort of nice pattern. The thing with this is this would always give us some unique values. Okay. So as you said, these are not geographically distant. So it is likely that somebody who is in US or Germany, and our nodes are here. And even though we are geographically apart, we can be very close in this notion of distance, right? And then you have local view. So local view is you have better idea of your surrounding compared to things that are far. It's the local view. So what this means and how we use it, I'll explain it later when it arrives, but this is the main idea. You'll get better idea soon. Okay, so there are the four main protocol messages and academically you have ping, store, find node, find value. Ping is simple, like you ping some node, it'll give you some reply. It's basically used to check whether a node is alive or not. Right? Store is you want to store some value. Find a node is you have some random node. You want to find information about it. You want to find its IP address, or you have some random key. You want to see where it is, where that key is stored. Right? So do find node operation on some node that you know of. What they will do is, they will return you with node IDs of K nodes, which are close to the node that you're looking for or the key that you're looking for. So when you do find node, it does not like directly return you the node that you're looking for. It returns you K closest node that it knows of. It's not the answer, but it's the closest answer. It's not one answer, it's K answer. Is this part clear? So feel free to disturb me in between. It's okay. It's nicer this way. Find value is very similar to find node, but in find value, if the node against which you are querying, if they have the value, they'll return you the value. Right? In find node, they will just return you nodes. Very simple, like four messages. Okay. So in this network, like Kademlia network, if you want to, if some a node wants to join the network, what do they do? How do they bootstrap? First thing like they need is they need to know at least one node. And if they know one node, they need to know one node. So one node in the network, they have to compute a random ID, right? Which belongs to the uniform ID space that we discussed, right? Add a bootstrap node to kbucket. Kbucket is so every node in Kademlia will store information in buckets of size k. Okay. So when it's information, there is information about node ID to IP address or whatever the information will be. Okay. So it'll store in buckets of size k. Most of these buckets, which are used in real world, they're either 8 or 16. So you add the node that you know in your k bucket. Then what you do is, then you do a find node query on the node that you know, the bootstrap node. And you try, and the query, you give your own node ID. So it's a self lookup. Like I'm trying to tell Praveen that, you know, find Kishan. Okay. So what you will do is, it will give me some K nodes that might know me. Okay. So now I have more nodes in my table, right? So if he gives me four people that might know me, I would add those four people in my routing table, right? So now I have more information. So say same thing happens here, right? It's a self lookup will populate other nodes with my node ID, right? So first the bootstrap node will take my information and then it will broadcast over it. It will also give me information about nodes, all the nodes which are coming in path of bootstrap node trying to find me. So now my table is bigger. Then I keep doing refresh. A refresh is like, no, I pick a random node which I know of and try to look up a random key. Now we don't know if that key exists. We don't know if there's any file or any node with that key. We just look up for a random key and we'll know about some random nodes which exist on it. Which might be good. So basically, we're trying to populate our table. And over time, somehow, our routing table, which would have more information about which are closer to us, how I'll come to that right now. Okay. So this is our range. Let's assume that our range is from 0 to 2, 2 raised to 160. Right. Let's assume that. And we picked up.
Let's see our. Setting up this setting of cluster initially so basically we use over the all the neighboring nodes information is same like if a node has k bus we just store it initially like in each, when you set the cluster itself or is it every time you find node is actually going to other id seeing it is inside the k neighbors or not yeah every time so the what do you call it the processing is I over there every time you find node it has to see all the nodes and see the nearest k neighbors.
Yes.
That's a good part, 2 plus 6 minus 1 nodes and see who are the
most
nearest neighbors.
Okay, so let me repeat this. So if I do a find node on some node, right? So I have they know my node ID, right? They have some nodes in the routing table, right? They will compare my node ID with all the nodes in their routing table, right? That will take this off. And they'll return K node. Let's say K is 4. So they'll reply me with 4 nodes which are closest to it.
You only get your nearest k neighbors. Do they propagate forward is what he was
saying? No.
That doesn't propagate. So the processing stops
at k. Yeah. So if now that I have that information, right, I know about these more nodes. Now I can choose to issue a request if you issue find node operation on them, but they don't propagate further.
So anytime you just want to have at most k increase,
And until unless you have the key entries, K number of IDs buildup, you keep on doing this.
Sorry, can you repeat?
It's like when you come up, you have to fill your node ID, K number of entries, K. And it will be about K number of nodes.
No, no. So you like it doesn't matter how many nodes that we know. It's okay if we know about a lot of nodes. By the system, right? So when you issue a request, they have the recipient of the request, they have to reply with K nodes, right? So I can issue like several requests. Right? I can have a lot of nodes in my route. It is okay.
One question.
Related
to the shopping. Okay. Right, so the SHA-256 is the address space, right? But SHA-256 is a hash without some data, right? So it underlying data that needs to have the uniqueness property, right?
Both has to have uniqueness property. So your node ID has to have uniqueness property. Your data, what do you mean? Data?
No, I mean, like say, let's say the address is some SHA-256 value, a hash.
Yeah.
Okay. So SHA-256 is basically a hash function on some data. And then you get the hash of the data, right?
Okay.
So, in order for you to generate unique values, unique addresses, which are SHA-256 hashes, you need the SHA-256 function to operate on data which is unique in terms of generation.
I see what you're asking.
SHA-256 on a UUID or something.
So, are you saying that I need some sort of unique seed to generate SHA-256?
Yeah, it has to be like the underlying data on which you operate the SHA-256.
I'm not sure how.
I think
the idea here is if you have some of the data, if two nodes don't serve, only one node serves. If there is existing data which is similar, and you get a SHA which is conflicting, like you said.
Sure. Yeah, but then as we would, ideally, you would want to avoid conversion, right?
SHA
is primarily to for the address space.
So address space is the data to be used.
Yeah, but is it using UUID or something? So I'm not sure how that generating random node ID happens.
If I'm not wrong, it's done on the data itself. So both of us are serving the same movie, there is a problem.
Anyway, the entropy is 2, right? The entropy they have put 256 addresses. So the possibility of having with such high entropy, the possibility of having the thing is very high.
There are some people who are developing IDFS.
I'm not very familiar with IDFS.
So there are some already.
That is what you will say super peer will embed in the client.
No, I mean, it's a community. It's not super peer. Right? If you know that one of your friends is running this node, you can open the IP address of your friend. But it's like you don't have so this is a community.
So whenever I download a big client, the master which are always running, so when I say like some IP servers which are always running, you embed the IP of that, so that the very first time to join the cluster, or to join the peer, it hits that master. How is the very first time it
happens? So when you have the source code, right? I mean, download the source code, like the source of Ethereum, right? So there will be
from where you download your neighbor information, and that's how it starts.
Yes. So I mean, you try to find random nodes. That's what happens. You don't know who the neighbors are. Right? Initially, you don't know where your neighbors are. You just not you try to know about random nodes on the network, and then you figure out who your neighbors are.
Yeah, but this random value will come from the master node, which are already pre-configured.
Yeah, but then once you have those values, you can send requests to those different nodes.
Right? Then it is fine. So there is a pre-configured some master node.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, so the problem is, so if this for providing this booster node ID addresses, right? Then it is very difficult for people, normal people. I want to run different transport IP addresses. I was finding some people who some of my friends who are running. It's some sort of a lot of friction over there. You know, they want people to use it. It's a permanent thing. People try to get it better. It's a centralization, but there are a lot of centralization, right? So somebody developing IP addresses, there's a developing community. Somebody developing, there's a developing community. In a way, it's a point of centralization. Right? So some things like those will always exist.
I just want people to know that.
Okay. Could we take further questions after this talk?
Okay, so we picked a random node in our ID space. So let's say our the random node that we found is 2 raised to 30. It lies somewhere in this space. Okay. So now our range of the bucket. So not size of bucket, it's the range of the bucket. Size of the bucket is how many entries you have or how many nodes you have stored in the bucket, which is 1. Range of the bucket is 0 to 2 raised to 6. Let's assume that our bucket size is k. Bucket size is 4. So k is 4. And this is the algorithm we'll use. This is what is used in KDMDA. Let's just go through briefly and we'll see in practice how it would look like. It's a presentation for the college PPT. So if a new node comes in and your bucket size has to increase. So let's say you already have 4 nodes in your bucket. You find about the 5th node, right? And you can't accommodate that 5th node in your bucket. So what you will do is, in the bucket, are you present, right? So is your own ID present in the bucket? If so, split the bucket in half, exactly in middle, okay? And then, based on where are those IDs sit on this scale, which I showed you previously, right, they would be distributed into different buckets. Okay. Now you would have 2 buckets. So if that your node ID does not exist in the bucket, okay, so you try to ping all peers in the bucket, or in some cases, it depends on implementation, or you try to ping the peer which you saw last. Okay. So, and basically, you're trying to find if everybody is alive or not. Basically, you want to get rid of somebody. Right? So if peer is dead, If you ping them, they don't reply. If the peer is dead, replace dead peer with new peer. If your peer is not dead, then throw away the new peer. Like everything that I have, whether it's good, I don't need you. Right? Okay. Why this? Like, why are we throwing? Like, why are we throwing away peers in other buckets, and why are we not throwing away peers in the bucket that where we are present? Guesses.
They have
your yes. Yeah. So the bucket in which we are present, right? So other nodes, like, they're closer to us compared to buckets in which we are not present. Okay. So you got new nodes. Let's say you have 14 nodes. You don't count yourself. So now the bucket size is 4. It's not 5 because you don't count yourself. Okay. So do we keep this peer or not? Yes, we do. They're in the slide. Okay. So we are in the bucket. Of course, we keep this peer. What we'll do is, because the size is increased, what we'll do, we'll split the bucket exactly in the middle. So when I say exactly in the middle, it would be somewhere around 2 raised to 159 or something, right? So you split the bucket. Now you have 2 buckets. Okay. Now your new peer. Right? Do we keep it or not? No, because it's a separate bucket. We don't care about it. It's far from where we are. Right? Okay. So eventually, you know, you'll get to know about more and more nodes. Right? And eventually, this would happen. The buckets which are closer to you would be very full and dense. So you would have now you're looking at this, like, you would have more idea of nodes that are closer to you. Do you get this part? Right? Because now after this, this whole, okay. So the main point is that if you are present in the bucket, you split it. If you are not present in the bucket and some new nodes comes in, you don't care about them. Like if everybody is good, like if all nodes are alive, then you don't care about them, right? You keep doing this exercise, and what would happen eventually is that you would have more nodes close to you, because whenever you are you're keeping nodes which are coming in the same bucket as you are, right? So after this, now there is this huge range from 2^259 to 2^60, right? There will always be just 4 nodes in that huge range, right? So now this is optimizing, right? So you're trying to find close and close nodes, right? And now you get rid of this part, as you find more nodes, right? You add more nodes and you'll split this range in half as well, right? So you're getting closer and closer as you find more nodes, right? As you keep splitting this range in different buckets, you're getting closer and closer, right? So your nodes table is densest around its own ID, right? So this is your local view that we talked about, right? So now you have more information about local view. This is
so in stacking with the k bucket, which is 16, but it will become more.
We started with one bucket. Size of the bucket is k.
Okay. And when we split, it will become more than k?
No, bucket size will always remain same. When we split, right, we're splitting the range. Yeah, now number of buckets would increase, right? Number of nodes that are in a bucket would remain same.
But we will split up till we will reach to the k bucket. We will not split more than k.
No, it's okay. Like, you know, as many buckets as you can have, it's fine.
What is k bucket?
K bucket is like, you know, type of like, you know, we have given this name, like, you know, this concept is given this name with a bucket having k nodes, k buckets. Okay. It's how, you know, when you write a research paper, like, you give some names to ideas or things. Right?
I thought it's a S table. S table is a bucket. So there are k buckets. If you say I have 16 buckets, so there will be 16 buckets, and any node will go into that node. So I was not expecting number of buckets to be increased.
Okay. So there can be any number of buckets, right? As long as, you know, we satisfy that range. Of course, not any number of buckets, right?
Yeah.
Based on that range. Yeah. So another thing is, like, you know, the same thing, but just illustrating in a different way, right? So your IP addresses, and this is like a tree-like way to tell you what is close and what is not, right? So you have this node ID, right? And you have represented them in a bitwise fashion, and you have created trees based on those nodes, right? So you have some random nodes like this, and you somewhere in here with Joe, right?
So now, if you see 7, so now you have more information about your own subtree. So Joe would know about this node or this node. I mean, most about this node. It would have some information about this node, some about this, right? But it does not have so much about this, or it has even less information about this subject. Right? It has even less information about this subject.
So what it will do is, it won't have all IP addresses stored. It will have some random things like this, right? So it has its own IP addresses, or not, okay, not IP address, like node ID, right? IP address is wrong word. Okay, so if I get this, it's my own node ID. If I get this 011, I know where to send it, right? So I send it to the next node or whatever the node I know. Like, you don't know all nodes, you know one node, right? So what you know is I send to this node, and this person might know some other node, right? If you this. So 01, so 5 is, I think, 0101, right? But you don't care about all this information. You have assumed that, because, you know, it's a little far. So anything you find with 01, you just send to that 5 node, right? Or anything that you, or any other node, like any other ID, this does not fit in this, you send to this different sub. You send to this different subtree, right? Okay. So let's say we are looking for 13. 13 is Alice. It's somewhere over here. It's a
different bucket altogether, right? You don't know any information. Yeah. So 13 would be 1101. If you see your hash table, right, there is nothing no entry starting with 1. It only fits over here, 12. What you do is you contact the 12 node. Tell them I'm looking for Alice. I'm looking for this node ID. Now, Alice would send it to here, 13. Now, it does not know the exact thing. What it checked is, it checked first three things. Okay, it's 110. I don't know where it is, but I think current networking routing, how routing happens in current system, right? Okay. So is this part clear, like, you know, how you're optimizing and how this is become more efficient and everything? So, yeah.
Is that the reason why we have the number of nodes and nodes because I think remembering nodes is pretty easy. Storing a lot of IP addresses is going to take up a lot of space.
So you want a certain pattern in the network, right? You want certain structure.
Why can't I just remember all that?
You can, but you have a limitation on your computer.
Also, like, we need to distribute it. Like, I know 100 nodes, you know 99 out of it. It means that the people who are coming to query us will not get more than those 100 nodes. It's better that I have separate 100 nodes, you have separate 100 nodes. So it's like evenly distributed.
So there are a lot of possibilities, right? How many nodes can be, right? So there are a lot of people. If you download like Bitcoin blockchain, or if you download so nodes, now when you say hash table, right, these are not just nodes. So it's not like how many number of Ethereum clients are running, or how many number of IPFS clients are running. There are other things also. There are files also. There are several files. So there would be so many different keys, right? And it's not possible for like our normal machine to store all those keys, right?
But we said we drop some nodes.
Because they are far from us, so
we could just remember them.
We can, but we won't be able to store the nodes which are closer to us then.
Really sorry to cut. I think any discussion probably keep it after the network. We can finish it off, and then all of you have questions, reach out to them and then discuss. Since we are running out of time.
Okay. So locating nodes, right? How you locate nodes in the system? You have something called alpha. Alpha is like how many number of concurrent queries you can run, right? So at a time, let's say alpha is generally 3. So at a time, let's say my node can request to 3 different nodes, can like do find node on 3 nodes at a time. So that's 3. So you run find node on 3 closest nodes to you, right? So somebody give you some query, you want to find some node ID. First you check your own hash table. First you check your own buckets, and you figure out, okay, who are these k closest people, right? And then alpha by alpha, right? So 3 by 3, you send them request, right? They will return you with nodes that they know of, right? So now you have more information. Now you probably know nodes which are closer to them than you earlier knew, right? So because they know better, right? And now you update your own information, you update your tables, right? And then you find which are k closest nodes, right? Then you send request to them. They would return something, right? Then this way you are getting closer and closer to node IDs that you're looking for. You're getting closer and closer to file key that you're looking for, right? And recipient, like as I said, right? When you receive a request, you send k closest node. Okay. And when you stop, so there'll be a time when you get next results, your next results won't be any better than previous results, right? So when that starts happening, the every time you run a request, like, you're not getting any new closer nodes. So it's of no use. So when that happens, it means that you have explored the network, and the nodes that you know of, they're the k closest nodes possible in the entire network. So it has traveled the entire network, right? So then basically you try to query them, like, and ask for the value if they have it or not. If they don't have,
then the value does not exist in the network itself. Okay. So the complexity here, like the complexity of lookup, is log n, right? Why log n? Because we try to split buckets in half, half, half. So every time you run a query, you are eliminating so many other nodes, right? And every time so that's why it becomes log n. Right? So even this would be enough, right? So first time you are eliminating half of the nodes, second time you are eliminating other half, and so on and so forth. So it's log n. And log n is like pretty good when you want information. Okay. Locating resource, that was locating nodes, locating resource. It's very similar to locating nodes, right? But what it will do is, if that node has the information, it will also return the information along with it. That's the only difference, otherwise there's nothing else. Okay. Storing. How storing would work, like this might be a little different based on all implementations, but generally what it would do is you found about some key, you have it in your own system, your own node. What you will do, you will broadcast it, you will explore it to your k closest nodes, and they will store it. They will, after some time, they will explore to their k closest nodes, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this kind of replication, right, it would depend. Like, there's something called caching also, which is used for making available like popular queries, right? Some movies or music, which is queried a lot. Right? But it depends on implementation. Right? Not everybody would implement replication and caching. Okay. Let's see some code. So one popular kademlia implementation that I know of is Go lib2b cat dht. It implements a distributed hash table. That satisfied IPFS routing interface. So you have all lib2b host and all IPFS related things. And this is a little modification, right? So this is modeled after these are some added modification of SKWS. S is for secure. So SKWS, some extra security things on top of KWS, so it exactly implements that. I mean, it does not have everything, but yeah, some things. So if you want to go check it out, you can go to this library, lib2b, go lib2b cat dht, and I've given a link to a function which does lookup. So probably it not be a good idea to go through the function and all, because it's a library. I was thinking if I could do a demo, but probably not. Just going through code might not be very nice. Anyway. SKDEMLIA. This is the last slide, like we are almost done. Okay. So secured KDEMLIA, like what they do is they make sure the world, like, the multiple things we'll talk about very few. So one is disjoint path. So you run the same query independently. So in normal node, like you want some query, you want to look for some node ID in KDEMLIA, you look for it. The same thing you do, but independently. You do it multiple times, you do it k times. Or not, you do it d times, whatever d it is. Okay. So you have parallel independent d lookups, and then you now have more information, you can choose from it. Basically what it does is, if there are some malicious nodes giving you wrong information, right, so it will still it will overcome that, because now you have more information. In previous situation, if somebody is giving you wrong information, you probably just accept that. Okay. Another is PKIA. Okay. Another. Any of you have heard of Sybiltex? Okay. Okay. So in P2P network, what people can do is IPFS, Ethereum, Bitcoin. So so this would somehow, like, these things somehow depend on how many nodes are there. Right? If you want to achieve consensus or do anything, like, the normal thing is your majority wins or whatever the system, right? So some normal person can do, like, I'll just create so many node IDs, right? And I'll become the majority, and I can do whatever I want, right? So that's a similar attack. So what you want to do is, probably you might have to have a stronger, better consensus system, right? What is used in crypto, like is a proof of work. So it becomes difficult to generate things. Like there's a crypto puzzle, and there's a because there's so much work goes on it, it's not so easy to come up with new things, right? So and what it does is it requires a node to create a PKI key pair, right? So in this system, right, probably like proof of work might be very expensive, right? Because that, like, you know, creating the node ID itself is very difficult, right? Creating a, if you want to mine a Bitcoin, it's so difficult, that this proof of work, right? Yeah. So if you're creating a node ID is very difficult, probably people won't use it. So this requires a creating a PKIs or public key infrastructure, your public key or private key, and you can verify stuff and you can send your messages and these two main things. So that's how secured Kademlia is different. I don't know if it is called secured. I'm just adding it. Some users, it's used in BitTorrent. So the BitTorrent has a tracker system, right? So there are these tracker nodes which have information about where things are stored. And then you have this magnet link. So in magnet links, it is used Kademlia. It's used in IPFS. It's used in Talks. It's a messaging system, voice over IP and video chat and everything. It's using I2P. It's called Invisible Internet Protocol. It's a anonymous network layer. It's a sensitive resistant and peer-to-peer. And if you watch House of Cards, somehow there's a Macing episode in there, and there was a mention of I2P there, and some interesting tidbit. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you so much, Christian. I think questions we can again take, like, I'll just have like take 5 minutes. So in the meantime, I just want you guys to open indiagolang.com, like over half mobile. There is a meetup page, and then there is a form in the sites. Like just five minutes, that way we know, hey, we can make this to us, we are more effective. In the meantime, I'll just show.